So ultimately, that means there's a lot of details in regards to these two individuals. Again, also in regards to matters safety on the sidebar of the paper, where border riders to be trained on safety and investment, and they're planning to begin this with the counties of Machakos and Kajiado. There's been a lot of talks in regards to how border operators actually operate when it comes to these roads, when it comes to the roads rather. So there's a lot of keen interest in regards to training them on how they need to be operating as they move about their businesses. I'll be telling you what exactly they're being trained about and how this is all going to play out. Still coming to matters education, there's also again been a lot of conversation in regards to girls being taking up STEM subjects. There's an article that really spells out why it is very important for girls to be embracing these subjects, which has been quote unquote being termed as, you know, part of what is for the males more often times. But now this article just well spells out why it is very important for girls to begin embracing the STEM subjects. And that is how the front page of the PD looks like this Tuesday.
Now, talking about the details, we mentioned that Mohammed Yusuf Haji, many will remember Haji, who died and was buried yesterday at the age of 80 for chairing the BBI team. But there's so much about the lives and times of Mohammed Yusuf Haji there. Just to give you a sneak peek is that in 2013, Haji was elected to represent Garissa in the Senate, and he successfully defended his seat in 2017. Now, the elderly statesman, aged 80, remained clear-minded, soft-spoken, and level-headed politician, good enough for the president to task him with chairing the contentious BBI process. He leaves behind a family with many interconnections in the Kenya-Somali community, largely through marriage. And two of his more outstanding progenies are Nudin Haji, that is the Director of Public Prosecutions, and businessman Abdul Haj. Now, Mohammed Yusuf Haj was born in 1940, and he's a member of the giant Ogaden clan from Kenya, Ethiopia, and Somalia. Purity Musa compiled the lives and times of Yusuf Haji, and here's a report.
Senator Yusuf Haji, the father of Kenya's Director of Public Prosecutions, DPP Nurdin Haji, was born on December 23, 1940, in Garissa District in the northeastern province to a Somali family. For his post-secondary education, Haji earned a diploma from the University of Birmingham, where he majored in management and finance control. Haji began his professional career in administration and management, where he joined the provincial administration of Kenya as a district officer in 1960 and went on to serve as provincial commissioner between 1970 and 1997. He was nominated to parliament in 2002, and in 2007 he was elected to parliament unopposed as Ijara MP. On 8th January 2008, Haji was appointed Kenya's Minister of State for Defense after the 27th December 2007 general elections under the Mwai Kibaki administration. And on 18th June 2012, Haji was appointed Kenya's Acting Minister of Internal Security and Provincial Affairs after the incumbent Minister George Saitoti died in a helicopter crash a few days earlier. Haji had previously worked closely with Saitoti on the Linda Inchi military operation. Haji held the new position concurrently with the Minister of Defense docket until a permanent internal minister was appointed on 21st September 2012. He has served in the Senate of Kenya since 2013. He died on 15th February 2021. May his soul rest in eternal peace.
The late Yusuf Haji there has been eulogized as a person who never left or never lost touch with his roots despite his status. May his soul continue resting in peace.
And you can also get to read more of the life and times of Haji on page 10 through to page 11 of the Daily Nation, from Jomo to Uhuru, the life and times of Yusuf Haji. That's how it has been captioned here. So we move on to This particular story that is on both front pages of the Star as well as the Daily Nation in regards to the farewell, the funeral of the late Mzenya Chai, and that is on page 4 and 5 of the Daily Nation, as well as page 6 of the Star newspaper this morning. And looking at the Star, they chose to look at the fact that this was the first time that President Uhuru Kenyatta and DP Ruto were meeting face to face for the first time since the Jamhuri celebrations that took place last year in December. And of course, the fact that there wasn't much politics at this particular funeral was something that was appreciated. But the fact that there was some arrests that were made prior to this particular funeral and the day before and just a number of hours before this. And they start off by saying tension was high as arrests of DP Ruto allies Mars and Yachai burial led by President Kenyatta. And it is said, according to this particular piece, that this arrests, these high-profile arrests were made due to the fact that they had reason as to plans to disrupt Nyachai's funeral services as a result of the tension between the two heads, that is President Kenyatta and his deputy William Ruto. So here they go on to say that in as much as they sat next to each other, President Kenyatta and his DP, they avoided eye contact through and through. And some of those who were arrested, individuals who were arrested, they're said to be strategic allies from the Gusii region that are allied to Deputy President William Ruto, starting with Kisii Deputy Governor, that is Josh Mangi, who was nabbed at the Kisii, at the Kisii school as he was waiting to receive Ruto, while South Mugarango MP Sylvanus Osoro was lured from the tent that was vetted for mourners. And on Sunday afternoon, police had arrested and locked up ex-Kisii mayor, that is Samuel Omwando, who's also another influential ally to Deputy President William Ruto. However, Osoro did come out to say that he did not know why they were being arrested. They did not give reasons as to why they were being arrested, but he termed this as attempts to harass and intimidate those who are allied to Deputy President William Ruto. The same story has also been captured here. Uhuru, Raila and Ruto pay glowing tribute to Nyachai. Though during the standoff, the function was hurried with only a few leaders allowed to speak. The president was rushing back to Nairobi for the burial of Garissa Senator Yusuf Haji, who also rested yesterday. So you can get to read both of those stories here on The Star as well as The Daily Nation. Doreen.
Same story also in the PD, and just as you mentioned, you know, viewers can get to read from whichever paper they feel suitable for them. But I mean, just want to read a quote from his son, that is Moses Nyachai. And this is what he said: "Dad was a hardworking man, the hardest working man I've ever known. He's someone that we all, as his children, try to emulate." That was that is a quote rather from Moses Nyachai, the son of Simeon Nyachai. Now, away from that, I want to come to that story again that also has dominated the front page, and this is in regards to matters road safety and how the state is planning to launch road safety trainings for motorcyclists. This is just what it says. Now, the government swung into action yesterday, and this was to launch a national road safety program targeting thousands of border riders. A special report exposed worrying increase in fatalities involving motorcyclists, and this is across the country. And also, this particular report showed how widows came out across this particular, especially these different counties that have been, you know, just mentioned in the article. And they narrated how their lives had to change after, you know, the breadwinners died in most of these accidents along the roads. Now, this training program will target 1.4 million border riders. The counties that have been mentioned so far that they'll begin, this will be in Machakos County, Kajiado, as well as Kiambu. This specific program also aims to inculcate discipline national values and mindset change among border riders while enhancing their skills and competences. Also, this comes at a time when just between January and actually where we are, as of now, at least 112 motorcyclists have died so far. So this is a program also being spearheaded by the National Transport and Safety Authority. And part of what they're mentioning also in this article is that this would not just be specific to these three counties that I've mentioned, Machakos, Kajiado, and Kiambu. However, this is where they're beginning, but it shall also be spread out to other various counties just to ensure that the safety on the roads. Wamboi.
All right, before we get to delve deeper into some of these stories, we want to take a very quick breather, but we'll be right back to continue with In the Headlines. But remember, our communication platforms are up and running. You can talk to us using the hashtag Good Morning Kenya on Twitter. At KBC 101 is the official handle, and our individual handles are at Dorina Range, at Ray Manyara, and at Jane Wamboi is how you can interact with us on the socials as well. Stay with us, we'll be right back.
Kwenye quickbit.co.ke siku ya leo ni Samsung A51.
Oh yes, na ni rahisi sana. Unaenda kwenye Lipa na Mpesa. Pay bill number ni 4032353. Account ni SM. Iyo ndiyo kodi ambayo ya Samsung. SM. Fuatanisha na unique number ile unafil. Alafu weka amount 20 bob peke yake.
Ekelea pili yako na hivyo ndivyo utakuwa umekelea bid kwenye quickbid.co.ke. Kumbuka ni bidhaa bora zaidi kwenye bei ya nini?
Chini kwa chini.
Jiunga na QuickBid ni rahisi. Enda kwenye M-Pesa, bonyeza paybill, kisha weka business number 4032353. Kwenye account, weka kodi ya bidhaa unayotaka na bidi yako ya chini zaidi. Kwa mfano, TV16. Kisha weka shilingi 20 tu kama idadi yako. Weka bidi yako pia kwenye www.quickbid.co.ke. Kumbuka, bidi ya chini zaidi ya kipekee ndio ununua. QuickBid, bidhaa bora kwa bei ya chini.
Malaria ni ugonjwa hatari sana unaoua watu wengi hapa Kenya. Japo kuko na corona, hatari ya malaria bado iko. Mtoto huyu alikuwa na joto jingi, kutetemeka, kuumwa na viungo na uchovu. Alikimbizwa hospitali ya umma ambako sheria za COVID-19 uzingatiwa na ni salama kwa shughuli ya upimaji. Vipimo vilionyesha kuwa ana malaria na papo hapo daktari akampa dawa za malaria na kumshauri azimalize na ili kujikinga wawe wakilala ndani ya neti iliyotibiwa. Malaria husambazwa na mbu. Walio hatarini ni watoto wa chini ya miaka 5 na akina mama wajawazito. Kupimwa na kutibiwa ni bure katika hospitali zote za umma. Usisahau adui malaria. Zero malaria huanza na mimi. Chukua jukumu leo. Komesha malaria. Ujumbe huu umeletwa kwenu na Wizara ya Afya.
The stage is set for the next football star from Africa to emerge at the Under-20 Africa Cup of Nations. Watch all the games live on KBC Channel 1 as 12 countries battle out for the ultimate prize of becoming champions of Africa. Raw talent, raw skills, ultimate technique. From Africa's finest and capped talent, witness footballing dreams come alive at the Under-20 Africa Cup of Nations from 14th of February to 6th of March 2021, live from Mauritania and exclusively on KBC Channel 1, your true sports partner.
Tonight on KBC Channel 1.
I can certainly do this to ensure your victory, brother.
Colorless and odorless. This is a poison of the highest quality. Ashok is so weak right now. Nobody can save you now.
Did you find the flower?
Glad that you're still keeping us company and watching Good Morning Kenya. And before we took that short break, we're just highlighting what the government has done to increase, to just enhance, road safety. And this is targeting boda boda operators. Remember, over the last few years, we've been seeing this sector actually grow. And with its growth, we have unscrupulous boda boda riders there who have been linked to road carnage, or rather road incidents, accidents and such, as well as theft on the road. Now the government has rolled out a nationwide boda boda safety program with the aim of curbing the increasing road carnage involving the riders. Ben Chumba has the details of that report. Where this happened is that Machakos and Kiambu also has raised concerns over the 4,500 shillings fee required for the training. Here is the report.
Thousands of border border operators could find themselves in a sticky situation for failing to raise the 4,500 shillings fee required for the nationwide border border riders training program. Speaking at Kajiado KCB grounds during the launch of the National Safety Program, Environment Cabinet Secretary Kiriako Tobiko called on stakeholders to support the program.
Border border sector maintains directly and indirectly over 8 million Kenyans. That's what percentage of the Kenyan population. That's a huge sector.
And the training will be done by NYS. And the whole agenda is to make border-border transport system to be efficient, reliable, and safe.
Similar event was conducted in Dumbeiri Stadium in Kiambu County, where CS Joe Musheru urged the border-border riders to endorse the program that will save their lives from accidents.
Enhancing road safety in the country, and specifically inculcating discipline, national values, and mindset change amongst border border riders.
In Machakos, Public Service and Gender Cabinet Secretary Professor Margaret Kobia led the exercise, where she said the future of the country lies on empowered youth. The national government, through the National Youth Service, NYS, is set to train 1.4 million border border riders on road safety. NTSA says up to 70% of border border riders in the country lack driving licenses. Ben Chumba, reporting for Channel One News.
Well, I hope that is going to ensure, increased road safety, as well as, good conduct among border border operators. They have been linked to so many incidences, including being used as getaway, means of transport for thieves, burglars and such. So I hope that this training is also going to be all-rounder to change the scope in as far as border border operations in the country are concerned. Now on to other news. STEM subject, where at least as of now, there's a huge gap compared when you come to the comparison of male and female when it comes to matters STEM subjects. And this comes at a time when there's a lot of conversation in regards to how so many jobs are found within that area. And this is when it comes to matters science, technology, engineering and mathematics, which is abbreviated as STEM. Also in regards to that, there's still so much conversation in regards to why females or women are not venturing into that field. A good number of those reasons have been well spelled out in this particular article, so I'll just mention a few, which is inclusive of matters culture, which is one of them that makes it difficult for also women to venture into that field, and the fact that women are not paid as much as compared to men in regards to what they do when it comes to their work. So that is just part of the reasons that have been put out as a result of why
women are not venturing into STEM subject. But even regardless of the reasons that have been put across, the article also just brings out the fact that it's still very, very much important for females to venture when it comes to matters STEM. Now, when it comes to also child trafficking, remember that we've had a lot of conversation regards to child trafficking, and there has been a lot of also talks when it comes to towns such as Nairobi, Nakuru, Kisumu, Eldoret, as well as Mombasa, where there's prevalence of such cases, where now the government has formed a special unit to deal with the rising cases of child trafficking in major towns. So these towns that I just mentioned are the towns in which they have identified where they'll begin dealing with this particular case. So in as much as they haven't really conducted a report per se to bring out which places or counties have become the hardest hit when it comes to child trafficking, but at least they have identified those towns that I just mentioned in which they'll begin dealing with this particular case, and once the bill is enacted, this bill will address the issue of child protection, adoption, foster parenting, and trafficking. Also, a report a statement mentioned by the Cabinet Secretary of Labor, he mentioned, and also it has been identified, that Kenya is the leading source when it comes to transit and illegal trade when it comes to matters child trafficking. So we hope that once this bill is enacted, at least this issue of child trafficking when it comes to matters protection, adoption, parenting, and trafficking will be dealt with. Ray.
To add on to what you just said about, you know, inclusion of women in STEM subjects, I want to draw your attention to the financial segment of the Standard this morning, and what the business development manager at Microsoft My Skills for Africa program has to say, and this is none other than Wanjira Kamwere, who says, only about 26% of AI professionals, that is artificial intelligence, globally are female. And this is according to the 2020 World Economic Forum report on the global gender gap. The report also found that the current trajectories mean that sub-Saharan Africa, where part of Kenya is, will only close this gender gap in 95 years. And which is another reason why we must pay attention to investing in women's STEM development. You can read more of this article on page 8 of the finance sector of the Standard this morning. And talking about women and inclusion, is that a lady yesterday made headlines. And this is none other than Dr. Ngozi Okorja-Iweala from Nigeria, who was appointed as a World Trade Organization Director General. Dr. Okorja-Iweala makes history as the first woman and the first African to lead the WTO. Her term starts next month, and that is going to be the first of 2021. Remember, our very own Sports Heritage and Culture Cabinet Secretary Amina Mohammed had also thrown in her chance to just want to take this position. But now the decision to appoint Dr. Okorja-Iweala was reached at a special meeting of the General Council. Her appointment follows a rigorous selection, as I mentioned there, that involved 8 candidates, one of them being our very own Sports, Heritage and Culture Cabinet Secretary Ambassador Amina Mohammed. You can get to read more details of her appointment and what it means for women, what it means for Africans now to have a lady and an African heading the WTO there. You can get further details on our website as well and get to know who exactly is Dr. Ngozi Okorja-Iweala, who hails from Nigeria. Congratulations, madam. That is well in for the women and for Africa at large.
Mm-hmm. If she was in South Africa, we would have said, thick madam. Thick madam.
Yeah.
Now, before I get to some bit of politics on the Daily Nation, I've just come across this piece on the Star. Brace yourself for mixed weather patterns until April. This is according to Met Boss. And this is just, it goes a long way to give me some hope, because this weather, by the way, imekuwa na mood swing, so undecided. It's not hot, it's not cold. Mara when it's hot, you are prepared for a hot day, ile mvua inamwagika. Then when you prepare for a cold day, ile jua inasimama, ni kama ina pepeto heavy, you know? But getting to this piece, it was expected that throughout January and February, it would be dry. It will be extremely dry. And this is according to, I'm going to say this very slowly, okay? World Meteorological Organization, hereafter referred to as a WMO, okay? So according to WMO, they had warned that we would be experiencing hot weather the early parts of this year, the early months of this year. But according to the trends, it seems to have been broken. As and the weather experts went on to explain why it rained last week, while confirming that the worst of La Nina has already passed. This was after they went back and just looked at the patterns and how things have been going. So they were expecting La Nina to bring extra dry weather into Kenya and risk drought. It was supposed to be that bad, but the latest updates shows that it already peaked. That is between October and November of last year, and the worst of it is already behind us, as now moderate strength events continue to play forth. So WMO went on to say that they still, however, do warn of a 65% chance likelihood that remnants of La Nina could still persist between now up until April, so we could be experiencing some extreme hot weather as well as intervals of rainfall until sometime in April. And they were specific to say that East Africa will be experiencing mixed weather patterns until April, when it's still early on the end to predict how the long rain seasons will behave later on in the year. But as it stands, January and February were expected to remain very dry, but this prediction has been broken by a series of rainfall episodes, and we should expect this mixed weather patterns until April. Then from there, they can be able to like give us a prediction of how the long rains will be. So but they take it day as it comes. Okay, lala usike kamvua kamemwagika, dress moderately warm, okay? Because we do not know how the day will be. So let's just wait and see how this will play out. All right, so that was a side note. Coming back to some bit of politics here on the Daily Nation, and this is in regards to the main story on the header here of the Daily Nation, the Hustler Thunderbolt, and looking at this particular bill that was fronted by Kiamba MP Poel Koinange, stating that basically this hustler versus dynasty narrative needs to be shut down altogether because it is dividing Kenyans along class lines, the rich versus poor. It's sort of a rich versus poor battle, and it's now gaining traction. And looking at the details of this particular bill is that this hustler versus dynasty campaign narratives could soon land some of these leaders in jail and consequently bar them from holding any public office moving forward. So this bill also imposes severe fines and jail times and makes it a basis of removal from office for any leader who propagates class division in the country, and especially during this political season that we are getting into. So if you are found culpable with some of these allegations, you are going to have to pay a fine of up to 5 million Kenya shillings or serve a jail term of 5 years. This bill was crafted by the National Assembly Security Committee to just try and classify this dynasty versus hustlers narrative as a basis of hate speech and discrimination among the people. So, and this is of course very evident. They were clear to say that the hustler who have christened the hustler part of this divide, who have christened themselves as to represent those who are downtrodden in society, while classifying the political wing led by President Kenyatta and Raila Odinga as the rich in the country. So the law also gives the National Cohesion and Integration Commission additional powers to investigate incitement on the basis of ethnicity, racial or social status, and recommend necessary disciplinary actions. So in regards to this hustler versus dynasty conversation, it is redirected to the crime watch space.
Well, talking about that is that now police are holding Kisii County Deputy Governor Josh Mangi and South Mugirango legislator Sylvanus Osoro for undisclosed reasons. And an aide close to the deputy governor disclosed that Mangi was arrested at the Kisii High School and driven off to the Directorate of Criminal Investigation Officers in Kisii for grilling, while Osoro was nabbed while trying to gain access to the Gusii Stadium, the venue of the late Simeon Nyachaya's funeral service. Story by Irene Mchuma.
County Deputy Governor Josh Mangi, South Mugirango Member of Parliament Sylvanus Osoro, and former ODM branch executive Samuel Omwando will tonight spend the night at different police cells after they were arrested for what sources allege they were planning to disrupt the late former minister Simeon Nyachae's funeral service at Gusii Stadium. Mangi is said to have been apprehended at the Kisii High School before being driven off to the Directorate of Criminal Investigation Offices in Kisii for questioning. He is currently being held at Oyugis Police Station. South Mugirango Member of Parliament Sylvanus Osoro was also arrested for unknown reasons and is spending the night at Kiroka Police Custody. Osoro was whisked by DCI detectives as he gained access to the funeral service of the late cabinet secretary at Gusii Stadium. Osoro attributes his woes to political rivalry in the region.
Your guess is as good as mine.
Former ODM chairman for Kisii, Samuel Omwando, had also been arrested on the eve of the funeral and detained at the Kisii Central Police Station. Irene Mchuma, ODM, Channel 1.
Now, we have to look at 2021 as a year where we're losing very many leaders so far. Yesterday it was Mohammed Yusuf Haji, and yesterday evening, Bonchari Member of Parliament John Oro Oyoka died in Kisumu. Now, Bonchari Member of Parliament John Oro Oyoka breathed his last Monday evening, and his family says he succumbed to a stroke at the Aga Khan Hospital in Kisumu. The MP was elected to Parliament during the 2017 general election on a People's Democratic Party ticket. Now the party is headed by the former South Mugirango MP Omingo Magara there. Now his son Solomon Oro told the media that the family would make an official confirmation letter, and we have the president eulogizing this particular leader, and I would want to take that to hear what President Uhuru Kenyatta has to say in regard to the death of Bonchari MP Oyoka. He says the member of parliament, Bonchari Member of Parliament John Oro Oyoka, who passed away on Monday, was an accomplished educator and determined legislator. Honorable Oyoka, a retired teacher and education official, was a second term MP elected on the People's Democratic Party ticket and died at a Kisumu hospital after a long illness. In his message of comfort and encouragement to the legislator's family, President Kenyatta described the MP as a determined leader who always sought and worked for the improvement of his constituents through education. It is a pity that the death has robbed us of a determined and progressive grassroots leader who used his long-time experience as a teacher and administrator to develop his constituents through education. May the soul of the departed rest in peace.
Well, yeah, and still coming back to matters politics, there's a very interesting article, if I can mention, with the main header, Why Uhuru Ruto Spat May Not End Anytime Soon. Just continues to say that the President Uhuru Kenyatta's call for his deputy William Ruto to quit instead of criticizing the government the equal run from within has now finally exposed even more deep divide in the executive. Now, while Ruto has responded that he will not resign, saying that he respects the president and will continue working with him on their common agenda. Analysts now have a different opinion in regards to that, as they are now painting a picture of an irrevocable split between the president and his deputy. This has also obviously come across due to the handshake as well as the BBI bill, whereby the DP has openly displayed his opposition, bringing forth different issues as to why he may be opposed to it. So in regards of, you know, matters BBI as well as the handshake, analysts are really coming out strongly to mention that their differences may not end anytime soon.
All right, let's now move on to the Daily Nation, to some bit of good news. And there's a piece here on page 25, some bit of international news, that Prince Harry and Meghan have officially announced that they are expecting a baby, all right, their second child. And this comes at least over a month since they last announced the miscarriage that Meghan did have. And this has come out as such beautiful news. So many people have had so much to say about this. So many people are excited for Harry and Meghan. I mean, these two have been lauded for just living their lives away from royalty, because one thing that Prince Harry has been known of is to speak against his own family, and not against in a negative way, but just standing his grounds, just like his mother did. And one thing that he made very clear is that his wife, Meghan, will not go through the same thing that his mother did under the name of royalty. And so, so many people have gone ahead to congratulate them. Buckingham Palace did put out a statement saying Her Majesty, Duke of Edinburgh and Prince of Wales and the entire family wish them well as they continue on with this pregnancy, the second baby that they are expecting. So that is some good news, at least, you know, some good news in light of all this darkness that we are seeing, you know. So we wish them the absolute best. Unajua wana watch Good Morning Kenya. We are together in spirit. Hello.
Now, I don't know if I should put a damper to your good mood right now. I'm unfortunately,
okay,
gospel songbird.
I know. I didn't want to touch on
Kambua.
That.
Mons is mourning the untimely death of her newborn days after birth. And she's quoted saying, "He was perfect."
I know. I read that yesterday and my heart fell.
You know, she announced being pregnant with her second child just 3 months ago. Mm-hmm. And 1 year after welcoming her firstborn, that is.
Maybe.
Now, the presenter said that baby Malachi died even as doctors strived to save the baby's life.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, she said, she eulogized her son saying, "You are deeply loved, and you'll forever be remembered.
Mm-hmm.
Your father and your mommy and your brother Nathaniel will carry you in our hearts always." You know, she said that she was appreciative of the fact that she had the privilege to carry a life yet again, despite the baby not staying alive for long after being born.
Mm-hmm.
He developed some complications, and despite efforts by the doctors to save his life, he lost the fight. Malachi is now free from pain and any worldly care. Our tears will fall freely because our hearts are broken beyond words, but our faith and hope remains unshaken because we have our trust on in a dependable God. That is what a grieving mom, Kambua, had to write a route after, you know, the loss of her child, barely hours after delivery. God, may God comfort you. I could feel her pain, and remember, before she even conceived her first baby, it had been, she's been married for so long, and I remember her saying that she's been asked this question, utazaa lini, and such, and it had weighed heavily on her mind. But she was blessed with a baby that is Nathaniel, and she was really waiting for her second born. But there she is.
God's,
there he is. That is Malachi.
Revealed.
He rests with an angel, the angels. And Mama, may you be comforted. I will not say I actually would understand that. I can't put myself in her shoes, but from one mother to another, that is some serious pain. May God give you comfort.
Yeah, what I may just want to say in regards to that is, I think what stood out for me is the kind of positivity. You see, even from that entire message, just what you wrote, you know, on the gram yesterday, and Kenyans were huge on support, even on Twitter, just giving her comforting messages, and the kind of positivity she depicted, that is a strong woman.
Absolutely. Malachi Manundu. May he, the beautiful boy, rest in peace.
How do you come back from that?
I know.
Yeah?
Do you go to politics?
Not in politics, rather. Uh-huh. This is in regards to fuel prices, and I just want to give an update because this is will be coming in tomorrow, which is on Wednesday, mm-hmm. and this is a message from the Vice Chair Matatu Owners Association, that is Ali Salim, in regards to the fuel prices hike and going up. He mentioned that tomorrow, which is on Wednesday, there will be a meeting to discuss the new fare prices. So it only means that now Kenyans need to brace themselves for a hike in fare prices as a result of the hike in fuel prices. But at least between just before tomorrow, he again also mentioned that Matatu operators should not hike any fares until when they come to that consensus and agreement after the talks. Ultimately, only means that the hike in fuel prices will also impact on most commodities, meaning the prices of different commodities here and there will go up, and we are seeing already one of them, which is going to be the fares, which is slated to probably go up as beginning tomorrow, which is on Wednesday. Also, part of what he mentioned, or part of what has been said here, is that there has been a lot of disregard in regards to these fuel prices going high because they have not yet considered the regulations or the protocols that have been put in place for Matatu operators, and this is when it comes to matters social distancing. So they're putting the prices high of fuel in disregard of these COVID protocols, and that's why they'll be meeting tomorrow to discuss new fare prices. So I need to give you this update because for those using public transport, they need to brace themselves beginning tomorrow for a hike in fare prices.
Go here on the FS of the Standard, just showing why fuel and power costs are likely to rise, and this is because the regulator is proposing new laws. Now, the EPRA acting boss that says if left open, rogue technicians and business persons are likely to exploit innocent Kenyans. Just want to read. This is in regard to a report as well as proposals there where the new petroleum regulations will operationalize the Petroleum Act of 2019, and the various set of regulations will affect how players in the midstream and downstream subsectors will operate. The new guidelines include a review of the fuel pricing formula, which they have factored in new components that might see pump prices go up. And this comes barely 3 months after a state agency announced that new regulations on solar energy subsector that sparked a lot of outrage among Kenyans who are shifting from grid power over its huge cost and reliability. So you can read further details in regard to what is happening as far as business and fuel and cost of power. Now, also just giving an overview what is happening in the rest of the world is that South Africa has approved the COVID vaccine and has opened land borders. Remember, we have been looking as South Africa has been on the limelight, given that they found out that the trials for the AstraZeneca's two-shot vaccine was less effective against the new variant of the coronavirus that is dominating South Africa. South African infections, and now they have picked to go with the Johnson & Johnson COVID-19 vaccine. However, they haven't started the inoculations yet, but they have opened up the border, saying that they have more faith in this new batch. They have received the first batch from J&J's, that is 80,000 doses, and they are expected to be arrive this week. This is according to President Cyril Ramaphosa, and we'll be keenly watching to see how this vaccine then reacts to you know, its effects on the second variant there that South Africa, that is dominating South African infections. Over to Zimbabwe, it has already received its first batch of coronavirus jabs, and these are 200,000 doses, and this is from Sinopharm. And this is their first batch. Remember, it's on the forefront. Just try and stem the spread of COVID-19. Over in the United States, is a support is growing for the Capitol riot inquiry after Trump was acquitted. Remember, he was acquitted for the second time over this issue at the Senate. And now what is seeing is that There appears to be growing support for an independent September 11 commission to the deadly insurrection that took place at the U.S. Capitol. Remember when we had the September 11 issues bombings in the U.S., they went independent into a commission. So this is just touching on what is happening across the globe, Africa, as well as further across the globe. And to just talk about our neighbors, what is happening in Somalia, according to proposed talks on Somalia's delayed election, well, they did not take place yesterday, and this is according to the local media. So you can get all this on our website at www.kbc.co.ke. But that's where we bring it, we bring this to a close in as far as in the headlines is concerned. But we are not done here on Good Morning Kenya. Thank you every person who's been watching and has made this possible. I'm Regina Manyara, and I wish you a great day ahead.
Just before we get to close, there's this piece I've just come across right now. It's actually on page 3 of the Daily Nation, and it talks of how they have found surrogates for the late rhino, Sudan's offspring, the last male white rhino that is known. Yeah, it passed on back in 2018. However, they had harvested some leukocytes and have been under storage, and they have now identified some 5 female southern white rhinos. Mind you, Sudan was a northern white rhino, so these southern white rhinos are going to be surrogate mothers for the offsprings of the late Sudan. They do say, however, there are 2 last remaining southern white rhinos, but they are not the 2 female remaining white rhinos, that is Najin and Fatu, aged 31 and 20. They are, neither of them can carry a pregnancy as is. So they have resorted to these 5 southern white rhinos to be surrogate mothers to this to the late right Sudan's offsprings, and they are hoping that this will actually come to fruition. They are now moving these 5 southern white rhinos into seclusion, ensuring they're not pregnant. They will be under 24-hour surveillance for the next 2 years, because the gestational period for rhinos usually ranges between 16 to 17 months. However, in order to ensure that a pregnancy is actually holds, it's going to take at least 2 years of these rhinos being in seclusion and a 24-hour guard to just make sure that these pregnancies
comes to term.
Yeah, they comes carry the term. Pregnancies to term. However, they do say that there is a 50-50 chance that it may be successful or it may fail, because this is the first time they're having this cross-species surrogacy, and especially with the southern and the northern white rhinos. Let's hope it works.
Yes, and I came across a fact too in regard. When we say white, it's actually white because it was actually referred to as wide. It has to do with, you know, the snout. It's that it is wide and not white. But now, over the years, we have taken it as white. Right? But it is wide. Ah. Wide has to do with the snout. Yes.
Here to always learn. But that brings us... Do you want a fact before Tufunge?
I see a fact.
I'm so ready to rejoin that. All right. So that brings us to a close of, in the headlines. Just stay with us. More of Good Morning Kenya after this breather.
mpya vitu mpya kwenye quickbit.co.ke. Siku ya leo ni Samsung A51.
Oh yes, na ni rahisi sana. Unaenda kwenye Lipa na Mpesa. Paybill number ni 403-2353. 403-2353. Account ni SM. Iyo ndiyo kodi ambayo ya Samsung. SM. Fuatanisha na unique number ile unafill. Alafu weka amount 20 bob peke yake.
Ekelea pin yako na hivyo ndivyo utakuwa umekelea bid kwenye quickbid.co.ke. Kumbuka ni bidhaa bora zaidi kwenye bei ya nini?
Chini kwa chini.
Jiunga na QuickBid ni rahisi. Enda kwenye M-Pesa, bonyeza paybill, kisha weka business number 403-2353. Kwenye account, weka kodi ya bidhaa unayotaka na bidi yako ya chini zaidi. Kwa mfano, TV 16. Kisha weka shilingi 20 tu kama idadi yako. Weka bidi yako pia kwenye www.quickbid.co.ke. Kumbuka, bidi ya chini zaidi ya kipekee ndio ununua. QuickBid, bidhaa bora kwa bei ya chini.
The stage is set for the next football star from Africa to emerge at the Under 20 Africa Cup of Nations. Watch all the games live on KBC Channel 1 as 12 countries battle out for the ultimate prize of becoming champions of Africa. Raw talent, raw skills, ultimate technique. From Africa's finest and capped talent, witness footballing dreams come alive at the Under 20 Africa Cup of Nations from 14th of February to 6th of March 2021. Live from Mauritania and exclusively on KBC Channel 1, your true sports partner.
Tonight on KBC Channel 1.
This is Mrs. Lucrecia Montesinos. I need to see you right away. It must be today.
Don't I just give you my card so that you can call me anytime you want?
Oh, thank you very much.
But didn't you and your mother understand that this is the big opportunity I've been waiting for my entire life?
Don't want to face your feelings. There's nothing I can do, Constanza. But I already did it. And you know what? It felt so good to admit it in front of the whole world.
No, you're not going to get divorced.
Tonight on KBC Channel 1.
I can certainly do this to ensure your victory, brother.
Colorless and odorless. This is a poison of the highest quality. Ashok is so weak right now. Nobody can save you now.
Did you find the flower?
Kwa mfano, ndani ya matatu.
Yani mtu mzima na miaka zake hizo miaka zote. Mtu ajui kujua kuandika not. N-O-T tu peke yake. Hey, kusapa kweli itasaidia.
Nini nakusumbua na nini?
Nauliza. Ni bwana.
Don't you dare insult me, okay?
Mama Angel.
And before we start with the day's conversation, how about we take a look at what is happening on our roads in terms of traffic, still focusing on what is happening along Jogoo Road. Looks like things are opening up a bit, but we'll try to look at some alternative routes in as much as things are opening up. This is how it is looking like, at least as of now. You can remember earlier on, there was more of the maroon color, especially as you leave the Dohnhoom roundabout, given the fact that this is also one of those roads that branches off from the major outer ring road. Also, there are other roads such as Juja Road, Manyanja Road, which again branch off from that major road, that is the outer ring road. And this is how it is looking like as of now. A bit of the orange color, which is an indicator that yes, there's still traffic, not as heavy as how it was earlier on. And I just want to be asked to begin from that roundabout there, or what we used to call the Donholm roundabout, as you head over to the city center. And this is the road situation. At least as of now, we can spot more of the green color, and like how it was again also earlier on. Look at how it is looking like on this section as you leave Manyanja Road, coming all the way via that intersect there again, coming through Jogod all the way to the city center. At least a bit of opening, that's why you're seeing that orange color there. And again, this is also specific to that lane as you come to the city center. So it's very obvious we'd be expecting to see heavy kind of traffic on major parts of this road, in as much as, you know, there's a bit of opening up here and there, simply because it is the early morning hour. So ultimately people are either heading to their workstation, their businesses. I also mentioned along this road, unlike many other roads here in the city center, where there's a, you know, on this specific one, there's a lot of businesses, and especially small scale businesses just along, you know, the roads. And also given the fact that it is one of those areas or roads where there are numerous estates, a number of them, so we haven't really seen a lot of road works to this specific route. However, at some time it was closed simply due to the what was happening around Likoni, but at least as of now that is opened up. So when it comes to traffic, you know, green all through, just specifically again as you leave the roundabout heading all the way to the city center. And the beauty of that is that this is actually on both lanes. So again, on this specific road, when I'm talking about both lanes, it just simply means as you leave areas around Mombasa Road, as you leave Manyanja Road, coming through the roundabout heading all the way to the CBD, and also leaving City Stadium, leaving the city center, leaving Likoni Road, coming all the way through Jogod as you branch off to, you know, to Outer Ring Road, as well as, you know, the other roads that branches off again from the major Outer Ring. So green, the green color goes all the way. So again, it just means that at least it's a smooth sailing if you are past the Donholm roundabout there, coming all the way to the CBD. And why I've kept mentioning that things are opening up a bit is simply because earlier on there was heavy traffic, not even moving at all, just at a standstill, what we would call a parking lot. Again, specific as you head over to the CBD, but at least as of now it is green all through, meaning that things have opened up, and at least it's a smooth sailing for our viewers, those using Jogod, those coming from those estates there, and even those intending to use this route, you know, either going about their businesses or just any kind of activities along this route. However, things begin to thicken a bit as you just near the Hamza Road Junction roundabout there, and again as you come all the way to the city center, also next to Uchumi supermarket there, also heavy kind of traffic, also specific to that lane coming to the CBD. But again, on this area, just where we are as of now, it is next to the Uchumi supermarket, so ultimately it means that there's a lot of activities there. And again, and at this particular place, it is also a bus terminus. So what we are seeing is basically what you'd expect to see, at least in this particular area, given those reasons that I just mentioned. But most of this is just specific as you come to the city center. So for viewers, again, coming from these areas, why you'll just have to make do with the traffic is after you pass the Hamza Junction, coming all the way to the CBD, again, next to Uchumi supermarket. But as of now, let's just try to see if we can get some alternative routes, because well past that area, which is the Hamza Junction, again past the Chimney supermarket, that traffic goes all the way till the city stadium roundabout. So it's heavy, you know, heavy gridlock there. So let's just try to look at one of the alternative routes, try to see if at all it can still serve as an alternative route, you know, if at all it's green or there's no traffic there. And this is one of them. Just before you get to the city stadium, again, if you're using Jogod, you can branch off through the Isili First Avenue. So that this particular route comes all through, and you can just see from our map again, it is green on both lanes. So meaning it can serve as a very, very good alternative route. So you branch off through the Isili First Avenue, come with the same route or with the same road, and you branch off to Juja Road, still through Isili. This is actually, again, green all through, coming all the way with the same route next to Karioko. Hall Market, and there you are, will be at the city center. So if at all you are coming from Jogoo Road and you do not want to make do the traffic past Hamza or even past the Uchumi Supermarket, the Isili First Avenue will be your good alternative route, and that is just before you get to that roundabout there. So come through the same route just as I showed you, and this is how it is looking like. Just as I mentioned again, green all through, nothing is changing there, so it means it's a smooth sailing all through and through. Coming to the same road, not branching to any other area, just with the same route all through. Where you branch off is just as you get to the Juja Road there again, coming with the same route past Isili there, connecting to Karioko Market, and there you will be at the city center. However, if you are already past, you know, the roundabout there, this is just as you get to the First Avenue Jogoo roundabout. If you're past there, then you will have to make do with that traffic. So that alternative route is for viewers plying Jogoo Road and they're not yet past the roundabout there. But if you're past the roundabout, then you'll have to make do with the traffic, which goes all the way to that stretch till the City Stadium roundabout again, as you branch off to Lusaka Road, coming all the way through Landis Road as you head over to the city center. But since our focus is keenly at least on what is happening along Jogoo Road, given the fact that there's heavy traffic on most of these major roads, on our other link-up segments, we'll be trying to look at some other better alternative routes for our viewers, again, either plying Jogoo Road or intending to use that route going about your businesses this morning.
Good morning, and thank you for staying with us. In case you are just joining us, karibu sana to the program. I am Jane Mumboy. Glad you have chosen to be with us. You can talk to us. Let us know where you're watching us from. Check in. Pale Twitter using hashtag Good Morning Kenya at KBC Channel 1 is the official station handle. And do remember to tag me as well at Jane Mumboy. It's how you can find me across Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram as well. Just to send out some love to everyone who's already talked to us, there's Bonface Musangi, I see Osieka International, there's also Yoruku, we have Nenda Letta, William Mamburi Kama Kawaida tuned in. And Mamburi actually goes on to say that Watamu Kama Kawaida tuned in all the way from Watamu, following very closely the comprehensive informative show, Simu Napendeza Sana Leo. Tunakuanga hivyo kila siku, imagine. But thank you so much for being with us. Keep those feedback coming in. I will sample them as we proceed on with the show. Again, the hashtag is Good Morning Kenya on Twitter. So right now we want to get into our first conversation for the day, and this is all about women at the forefront. This is where we get to have a beautiful conversations with women who are breaking that glass ceiling that I don't know who put there. Allegedly, society did. But we are here to let you know that that is not a reason to hold you back. And when we talk about women at the forefront, it's not just about encouraging other women. This is using women to encourage everyone in society. And today we have with us Mwende Mutua, who is the director of a Future Focus Catering College. Karibu sana, Mwende.
Thank you, Jen.
It's not the first time we're having her here. Yes. So we've had her here before, and we're glad to have you back again to continue with this conversation about the youth.
Thank you very much.
Maybe you could start by giving us a social media for our viewers to also interact with you.
You can find us at Future Focus Catering College. That is on our Facebook page. Our Twitter handle is at Future Focus at Catering for Future.
All right.
Yes.
So check them out. If you are a youth, you are interested, you just want to know what they offer in line with you as an individual, check them out. Any questions that you feel you want addressed here, shoot them through. I got you. We'll be addressing them in a bit. First of all, we touched base since we last had this conversation. How are things back in school with this new year, new way of doing things, at least for the students?
would say it's very smooth, eh? Mm-hmm. And considering that our students have been home since March, eh? So it's like a toll of a lot of work. It's like we're starting from zero.
Ground zero again.
Yes, because you know a lot happened, eh? It's around, was it 7 months or 8 months?
8 to 10 months.
Yeah. That's a lot of time, eh? For a student who has not been in class. Mm-hmm. So it's really a lot of work for us. It's like we're starting from zero again. But we're doing it. This is what we love.
And you know, we did see tertiary institutions be the first to be allowed to reopen. Mm-hmm. But from where you sit, what are some of the lessons that you as an educator have learned from what COVID has taught us? And you feel that these are necessary lessons you need to carry on for your students as an educator to just make sure that in the event something like this happens again, mm-hmm. we are better prepared.
I think COVID came with its own fair of challenges, mm-hmm. but it also came with opportunities.
Yes.
Because many of us, not even the tertiary colleges, mm-hmm. we could not have told that one day we can sit home. Have we ever seen schools being closed? It has never happened. Mm-hmm. So it means that, and more especially for us tertiary colleges, it's good to give students skills that in case we are not working, in case you're not supposed to report to work what you're doing, what will you be doing? I think it is a lesson that it did not only come to the tertiary colleges, but as a nation as a whole, eh, mm-hmm. that we should have something, a skill that can keep us running.
Yes. Absolutely. And that is why I want us to just dive into when it comes to this whole conversation. And I love the fact that you are a woman who is at the forefront in this education sector of our system here in Kenya. And most are now looking at the opportunities that lay there for our youth. And I want to start with the courses that are offered. And we always have this narrative of I want to go to school, do a four-year degree versus those who do short courses. From where you sit, what are the pros and cons of each of these two types, the short courses versus a fully-fledged degree?
I think, Jen, there's a gap, eh? Mm-hmm. And more especially when youths are choosing what they want. We are used to education system whereby from class 1 to class 8, now using the 844 system, eh?
Yeah.
We are given a choice of what should happen to our lives. Mm-hmm. From form 1 to form 4, everything is dictated. And now it becomes, the gaps comes in when in you going for the university or the hell levels, and then someone chooses it for you. Mm-hmm. So can you imagine having to do something that you don't like, maybe 8 or 10 hours in a day, 7 days a week, and maybe 24 hours, for a whole year, you find that at the end of the day, you might not deliver. So students will go, do the course for you, but they won't practice it. And that is why you find many people will toil with those papers, mm-hmm. because they say they are not opportunities. Because if you do something that you have passion for, I'm telling you, look for that opportunity. Yeah. Because you not see any challenge that you'll have in something that you needed to do will be like, it will be, you'll think positively and see a way through. Mm-hmm. So that is why you find the problem is starting on the choice of courses. What influence do we as parents have on what the youth wants to do?
Yeah.
How do we influence them? Mm-hmm. Maybe because you wanted to become a doctor and it wasn't possible for you. You make your daughter become a doctor.
They live the dream for
yes,
you.
Yes. So you find that every setback he finds in their career, they'll be like, this thing is not working. Mm-hmm. It's not because it's not working. It's because they don't see themselves in it. So I think it should start with letting the students do what they want.
Either wants to choose.
I have seen parents are having issues like Future Focus. We normally offer 3 months training. Eh? Mm-hmm. You find some parents are having questions. What can you train for 3 months?
Yeah.
And somebody gets an opportunity. So you find there's that notion of it needs to be 4 years. Mm. It needs to be, it's the long you train. But I would say as a trainer and as a mentor, it's not about how long you train. It's a matter of what is the passion, mm-hmm. what do you want, and what is the goal.
And that's why I want to just look at now that particular aspect in line with the mentality that our youth of today have, because we have been taught kindergarten, primary school, at least with the 844 system, secondary, that's 3, 8, 4, and university 4 years. Mm-hmm. That is what we believe to be education.
Yes.
But now we're living in a time where we're having so many short courses that are being offered, and you still find so many young people refusing to go to tertiary institutions, colleges, and do these short courses in the, on the account that, you know, it's not what I want to study. Yes. I want to go ahead and do this degree that I think is right for me. And yet there's also a short course mm-hmm. that could package them immediately mm-hmm. and avail to them an opportunity. Mm-hmm. Changing the mindset about short courses among the youth. What can we do about that?
I'm thinking mentorship can really work. Mm-hmm. And it starts from the parents. Because I'm telling you, if I am a parent and I am discussing, maybe if maybe a student can hear maybe us talking about Future Focus, which trains for 3 months, mm-hmm. and they go to their parent and tell them, maybe I think I have a passion in hospitality. I want to do this course. And then they say, no, why should you do a course of 3 months when we can offer the same for around 4 years?
Yeah.
You know? So you find it's the mindset that the mentors, these youths, look upon to. What is their mindset? Because if they believe a four-year course is what it's workable,
yeah.
then you find that the youths will not have a choice. And last time when I was here, Jane, I mentioned, and I think one day we'll invite one of the employers and they'll tell you, they prefer sometimes even those who have done the short courses mm. to degree students. And the question comes in, where is the gap? Considering this person has done this thing, I'm at this training for 4 years, and another person has done the same training for around 3 months, and the employer is preferring the person who's done the course for 3 months. It's all about mentorship and training.
Mm-hmm.
What are you, as trainers, what are we telling these youths when they're in class?
Mm-hmm.
What are we preparing them into? Because I'm thinking, apart from the technical skills, when you get into that job industry, your life skills will sell you.
Mm-hmm.
How well can you handle, like for example, we are training in the hospitality industry. How well can you handle guest complaints? How well can you serve the client? Mm-hmm. How well can you make the customer happy? That is what the employer is interested in. So it's not about what did you get? What was your transcript reading? If you had an A, maybe you have a first class honors in your hospitality management certificate, and at the end of the day, you cannot handle guest complaint, then to them, you have a job for 1 month. The second month, they don't need you.
They dismiss you.
Yes.
Now, you had mentioned that, you know, parents have a role to play in this, but also as educators, do you think we are also part of what has contributed to this rigid mindset? Because we tell them, ukimaliza fanya internship, get employed. And for most people, you think employment is white collar.
Yes.
That instant gratification mentality,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to other manual job and blue collar kind of jobs.
Mm-hmm.
The role that parents and teachers have had to play towards building this mindset that you need to finish here and get a white collar job, as mm-hmm. opposed to another more manual job that would be beneficial for you as a starter.
Mm. I think here, we have impacted in a way.
Mm.
And I think we can change that by offering guidance. If I can use what we do as an example, for you to package what is being taught in another tertiary college or universities, to package it to three months,
mm-hmm.
it means there's something that you're doing out of extraordinary. And you find that sometimes the trainers need to show this at youth. How do I make myself relevant
yes.
in the course I'm training in?
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, we are used in this culture of you do first year, you pass your exams, you given an examination body, you do second year, then you go for internship.
Mm-hmm.
But why don't we embrace a model like whereby during training, don't even give certificates to these youth unless they learn to vent and look for those opportunities for themselves. Like, for example, during our training, after the first month of training, every trainee is tasked to look for an area, maybe a hotel, and place themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Why? And if you don't do that, you will not graduate, you will not get a certificate. Because it's not a matter of training. After you train, what is the impact after training?
Mm-hmm.
Because you can have, and that is why you're finding youths are doing one certificate, another certificate, and another certificate. And at the end of the day, they don't have a job. Why? Because after training, there's hustling, looking for the job. So why don't we, as trainers, why don't we teach these students to start hustling while they're training?
Mm-hmm.
For example, most of the colleges, they don't train throughout the week, as in like Saturday and Sunday. In Future Focus, we train them on Friday. Can you attach yourself somewhere? Go ask the opportunity, walk into a hotel, talk to a manager.
and get an opportunity for yourself. Let us come on Monday and discuss the challenges. Mm-hmm. So you find by the end of the training, the trainee is already aware of what they're getting themselves into.
Yeah.
I remember, and you can tell me, what you had when you were in college and what you found in the industry was a mismatch.
Mm.
And if you are not fit enough, you could have left.
Yes.
I could have left.
Mm-hmm.
So why, and that is why you find if they don't have that preparation and we manage the expectations, you find no matter how much you're going to train them, no matter how long we're going to train them, there will be a mismatch. So I think it is also the role of the trainers to show them and prepare them to the world that they're getting to themselves into. That is the world of employment,
yeah,
or the world of business.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Now, you've mentioned this whole conversation about certificates, and it takes me back to another conversation that I was having with someone in a different space about how we're living in a time where even as the employed, you're taken for what are they called, trainings, then after all that you're all given certificates of participation.
Mm-hmm.
And looking at that, it's breeding a system that, you know, there isn't no need to put effort, because if we're all going to get certificates of participation,
mm-hmm,
why should I put effort to do better than mm-hmm the other person?
Yes.
Because if I do better and the other person seated next to me is not doing anything, and we're all given the same certificate, mm-hmm, what value is mine?
Yes.
You know, mm-hmm, that is a culture that is thriving here, and we really need to think hard about that. You know, what value is there in effort? Because the longer we just show that your effort and the person who's not putting in effort is on the same level, then what are we telling our youth? Now, this brings me to the next aspect about now looking at tertiary institutions and the fact that there isn't some sense of harmony,
mm,
even in the courses that are offered. You will find the training that is being offered, for example, at Future Focus is completely different from a different institution that is still in the hospitality industry.
Mm.
And consequently, when these two people are placed in the job market,
exactly,
you find that they're supposed to be doing something that is similar.
Mm-hmm.
At least there's supposed to be some cohesion in what they are doing, but there's such a disparity.
Mm.
What can we do to just make sure that even as people enter the job market,
mm,
they know what they're going to do and there's some sense of harmony, as opposed to having a disjointed way of functioning and consequently,
mm-hmm,
not being able to hold ground?
I think the challenge comes in, there's some, like for example, Future Focus is a private institution.
Mm.
So it means at the end of the day, you're in for business. But there are some of the businesses that are more than a calling.
Yeah.
Because I can come to class as long as students have paid fees, eh? And then you just, the way you finish and then you
talk
go.
Talk and go.
Yes, you talk and go, you finish and then you go. So when this student who has come from such a background, and maybe another student, it's the college is not just a training, it's not just a business.
Mm.
It's like they hold the passion. Eh? You find that there'll be a mismatch. And you find that it's very hard. I won't say that the government has really put the regulations to see what is really being offered, because
yeah,
they cannot just come to any class when every trainer is training. When I get to class, I am the one who is delivering to the students, isn't
mm-hmm
it? I choose what to tell them. So it becomes a challenge, and it becomes a call for all the trainers.
Mm.
What are we telling our trainees, whatever you're training? Are you telling them something that can impact them,
mm-hmm,
or something that is universal according to what you're training?
Yeah.
So I think it is like a personal decision, and more especially, training is a calling. You give what is required of you and you give it to the best.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that can only be determined even by the trainers. And what kind of trainers are you having, and what are their core values? Because there are people who get to class and just to pass time.
Yeah.
Even if I'm the director of Future Focus Catering College, I don't know what is happening in there now. The only people who can continue the dream and train according to your goals is if the trainers identify with the same vision like as you do.
Absolutely.
So I think the trainers, the people who train in different colleges, have an impact on the results of the trainees that we're going to produce.
Now, in as much as we're also out to make sure that we want impactful training instilled in these young people, We're also moving to a time where the world is slowly shrinking and becoming a global village. Therefore, boundaries are slowly coming down. Looking at the quality of education that we are offering here in our country, do we think we are gearing up for a futuristic way of working such that if I am trained here, I can confidently work in a different country and not have to like go back and relearn how to be relearn how to work in that space, because what I was taught is not of world-class standards?
I would say yes, because like for example, let me give an example on hospitality.
Yes, please.
That is my area of expertise. If I get in class and teach a student how to set a table, it is universal. If you go to Dubai, that is how they set a table. If they go to any part of the world, that is how they set a table. So the question is, where are you getting your training materials? How do you train? So I mean, if you use a curriculum that is valid and you don't train from the bush, you find that what we'll be offering, it will be universal, and you find that it can be used in any global world. Yes.
Now, I love the fact that you've talked from an area that you are alive to, but also just looking at the rest of the courses that are offered in our country and the education system as a whole. Are we setting up our youth for proper opportunities? Our system is also limiting them to some extent.
I would say it is. It is kind of limiting to some extent because you look...
For the opportunities.
Yes, for the opportunities. Because we are more especially considering our mindset, our level of training. You find, and you know now, you go, there's this system whereby you find some students wako mbele ya wengine. So you find some of us will, some of our trainees will be challenged, and more especially trainees who come from very poor or humble backgrounds. They will not have access to that. Look at when COVID came in. How many schools could do online
the
training?
Online training,
even university, even tertiary colleges. How many could do that? So it means a small challenge will have an impact on our education system, don't you think so? So it disadvantages us in some way. And then you find that we cannot cope with the global market.
Absolutely.
Yes.
And that in the long run will hinder some of these opportunities that we are striving to make available to our youth. Yes. Again, I welcome you to be part of this conversation. If you are a young person watching us this morning, I'd love to hear from you. What are your thoughts when it comes to the opportunities that are available for you as a youth in this country? Do you feel that, you know, the education system here in Kenya has set you up for opportunities here in Kenya, or and beyond for that matter, or you feel that the system, education system to be specific, is part of what is hindering you from the opportunities that are in the market? We are complaining of unemployment for the youth. You know, just yesterday I came across another video of a young lady who was put up this video, and she was crying. She was desperate for employment. She went to school, did her degree 4 years, and after that she has been struggling to get a job. 4 years after having gone to school, still struggling to get a job. I think it's been 2 years now. She's still at home, struggling to get a job. Anapatanga to remind us kila siku from this fintech applications, you know, taking a loan to just try and get you by. That is the reminder that they have every day. And yet, they have had the education. What is it that is making these opportunities less available for our youth? And this brings in this whole aspect of exchange programs. It's still a very foreign concept here in Kenya. At least some private institutions have embraced foreign exchange programs, you know, just sending their students to different institutions abroad and the other way around to just get a feel of how things are there. Do you feel that this is something as Kenyans that we need to embrace, and also our institutions, to just expose our youth to different systems and cultures and environments to just make them ready, more ready for opportunities that they may come across that they didn't know could actually fit them?
To answer you, Jen, I would want to comment on the video you said. And the dilemma is, sometimes I find you find employers, they're looking for people to employ, and they don't even have. Sometimes I remember you fail even to pick calls because you don't have people to place. So the question comes in. Employers are looking for people to employ, and people who have gone to school are looking for jobs.
Yes.
Where is the gap? Where are we losing each other? Because you can go there are advertisements all over sometimes, but when people go for the interview, or you can find that employers are recruiting, they're interviewing more than 100 people, and they're not even able to get someone who is fit for the position.
Mm-hmm.
So that brings a question to our education system. And you find that these people will be having very good papers. But the employers, they don't consider those people for employment. So yes. The question comes in, what are we really training in our training institutions? And as much as we're looking for these exchange programs, are the people, the products that we're producing fit for the job markets that are in?
Okay.
Yes.
Now, I just want to bring in a rejoinder to that particular video. And she further on went to say that... the fact that she hasn't gotten a job for so long did not stop her from wanting to create employment for other youth. And, you know, this is something that the government is always encouraging. Yes. Be an employer, be an entrepreneur, start that. But then again, she talks of how when she went to register her business, she went through the process, and then there was a problem with one of the names for the business. And when she made that correction, she was told that she needs to pay an additional $7,000 to register her business. Now, mind you, this is someone who's not employed.
Yes.
They don't have the money to just start by registering a business and create those opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
Also looking at the laws of the land that be, are they empowering this youth to create these opportunities for themselves?
I would say no. They're not. Because you find that there are a lot of bureaucratic processes that the youth have to go through. And can you imagine, this person has been mentored and told, I think you can start your own business.
Yeah.
It's important you start your own business.
Create
employment for others. And then they go, they find the documents that they have to produce to be able to do that business, they cannot even afford. So you find that it becomes a setback to them again. They start thinking, oh, it's not possible, it cannot work. So I can say, to some extent, the government is not really supporting the youth, and more especially, the bodies that are supposed to make it easy for the youth to become entrepreneurs are not doing the right, they're not really supporting them.
They're
making even it hard for them to survive in the business. And after they register the business, if they manage to register the business, you find there are other charges that they need to do.
Yes.
Maybe there are some levies you need to pay to the county. There are other licenses that you need to take. You find in a particular business, you have to take like three or four licenses at least. Yes, that becomes a challenge. So I would say the government is not really doing enough to make sure that even the youths who want to become entrepreneurs or people want to become entrepreneurs do it swiftly. They are really having a lot of challenges at transforming into that.
And what do you think can be done to this then, to just make sure, in as much as you're coming out of school and employment is not readily available, that the environment is conducive enough for you to at least set something up? What are some of the suggestions, very briefly before we go for a break, that you would put forth to this end?
Pardon your question kindly.
The suggestions that you feel would be good for the youth to just make sure that the environment that they find after school is conducive for them to start a business as opposed to wait for employment.
One thing I would really advise is we start small. Because sometimes the more, the bigger the business, the more involving it will be. So you, and it all starts with having a plan. I've seen challenges that youth think when you start a business, it's all about the capital. It's more than the capital. I'm telling you, sometimes if somebody tells you, I'm going to give you 100,000 to start a business, you might not know what to do with that 100,000. So when we start small, we will have the plan. What will I need to start this particular business? What will be required of me? What are the mitigators that I need to have done before I started? Because when we start small, it will not really challenge us very much. The challenges that we are going to find will be something that will not overwhelm you, because businesses are really overwhelming. So if you start small, it will be easy for you to transit.
Don't bite more than you can chew when you're starting fresh from school. Well, we are having this conversation with our Women at the Forefront guest this morning, just trying to understand the opportunities for our youth in this day and time. We want to take a break, but we'll be right back to continue with this particular conversation. Keep talking to us. I will be sampling your views after this breather.
mpya vitu mpya kwenye quickbit.co.ke. Siku ya leo ni Samsung A51.
Oh yes, na ni rahisi sana. Unaenda kwenye Lipa na Mpesa. Pay bill number ni 403-2353. Account ni SM. Iyo ndiyo kodi ambayo ya Samsung. SM. Fuatanisha na unique number ile unafil. Alafu weka amount 20 bob peke yake.
Ekelea pin yako na hivyo ndivyo utakuwa umekelea bid kwenye quickbid.co.ke. Kumbuka ni bidhaa bora zaidi kwenye bei ya nini?
Chini kwa chini. Chini kwa chini.
Jiunga na QuickBid ni rahisi. Enda kwenye M-Pesa, bonyeza paybill, kisha weka business number 4032353. Kwenye account, weka kodi ya bidhaa unayotaka na bidii yako ya chini zaidi. Kwa mfano, TV16. Kisha weka shilingi 20 tu kama idadi yako. Weka bidii yako pia kwenye www.quickbid.co.ke. Kumbuka, bidii ya chini zaidi ya kipekee ndio ununua. QuickBid, bidhaa bora kwa bei ya chini.
The stage is set for the next football star from Africa to emerge at the Under 20 Africa Cup of Nations. Watch all the games live on KBC Channel 1 as 12 countries battle out for the ultimate prize of becoming champions of Africa. Raw talent, raw skills, ultimate technique. From Africa's finest and capped talent, witness footballing dreams come alive at the Under 20 Africa Cup of Nations from 14th of February to 6th of March 2021. Live from Mauritania and exclusively on KBC Channel 1, your true sports partner.
Gear up and maintain a healthy, fit and active lifestyle right there at home by keeping up with Gear Up on Channel 1, 5:30 to 6 a.m. Monday to Saturday. Gear up every day for every moment and remember to stay home and keep safe.
Tonight on KBC Channel 1.
This is Mrs. Lucrecia Montesinos. I need to see you right away. It must be today.
Don't I just give you my card so that you can call me anytime you want?
Oh, thank you very much.
But didn't you and your mother understand that this is the big opportunity I've been waiting for my entire life?
Don't want to face your feelings. There's nothing I can do, Constanza. But I already did it, and you know what? It felt so good to admit it in front of the whole world.
No, you're not going to get divorced.
Tonight on KBC Channel 1.
I can certainly do this to ensure your victory, brother.
Colorless and odorless. This is a poison of the highest quality. Ashok is so weak right now. Nobody can save you now.
Did you find the flower?
Welcome back. We are glad you are still with us. I'm Jane Mumboy. And before the break, I had mentioned that I will be sampling your views when we get back, and we are back. So let me just read one tweet from Richie, who's saying, I love that issue that you mentioned about exchange programs. We need to embrace it more as Kenyans and get to learn from other institutions across the world. Number two, the youth need to be alive to all the opportunities that are available to them and stop always complaining about unemployment. Now, this reminds me of this whole aspect of the online platform. We're living in a time where there are so many opportunities on the online space. You can be living here and working for companies that are in different parts across the world.
Yes.
Do you feel that our youth are also not taking advantage of this online platform that they have available to them, which is tailor-made for the young people to thrive?
Yes, I would say that, because they have a culture of
nitafutie kazi.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've really put that culture into our youths whereby if it's your brother anakuambia nitafutie kazi, and how you help them in looking for that job, maybe you get to online and look for the job for them. Mm-hmm. So you find they are lazy enough. They really don't want to go the extra mile.
Yeah.
And you know, Google has done, and internet has done everything easy for us.
Mm-hmm.
You just, maybe if you Google now, jobs in this, mm-hmm. you'll get like a million or whatever.
So
you know?
many of them. Yeah.
But how often do they do that? I remember my second job, I did not know anyone.
Mm-hmm.
I got that through that. So I think they have not really impressed the online platforms that have opportunities for youths.
Yes.
Yes.
So, y'all, we need to wake up to, especially COVID has taught us that traditional way of doing things will just one day cease.
It's true.
So when that happens, utadu. Utabaki hapo ukikomplain hakuna kazi, and yet you can take up your phone and do tons of jobs and get some good money to take care of you.
Mm-hmm.
You can get on that online platform, offer hospitality services to somebody who is in a different county and get paid for that. Be alive to all these opportunities that are available for you. Now, as we bring this conversation to a close, something that the youth also don't take advantage of when it comes to the opportunities to get to study is scholarships and grants. I see so many scholarships being advertised, but very few people are actually active enough to follow through, apply, whether it's a full scholarship or a half scholarship. For the youth who are watching us this morning and they are in a situation where they may not be able to afford tuition for themselves, understanding the importance of looking for some of these scholarships.
So what I would say, Jen, is sometimes I think we limit ourselves to opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
Apart from being the director of Future Focus Catering College, I also work with an NGO called CAP Youth Empowerment Institute,
mm-hmm.
which is a sponsor for MasterCard. And what CAP Youth Empowerment does, they train youth for free.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm telling you, at our centers, we lack numbers
yes.
to train youths. So that is a sponsorship which is already there.
Full scholarship.
Full scholarship. They only pay a registration of 2,000,
mm-hmm.
and the training is free. They are trained for 3 months and they are placed also.
Mm-hmm.
So you find that even when those scholarships are there, you'll find that the youths are not there. So it's a matter of where do you position yourself to get these opportunities?
Mm-hmm.
And even the opportunities are there, are you ready to train?
Yes.
Are you ready to grab the opportunities?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm thinking sometimes it's not that the scholarships are not there, but you really have to work hard to get them. And when the opportunity comes, you really have to grab it and run with it. Yes, so I would not really say that opportunities lack.
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling you, we struggle. Sometimes you find even centers are being closed because we don't have numbers. And even in that area, you find youths are doing nothing. So I think it's something that we really need to get out of ourselves
mm-hmm.
and stop complaining and embrace what is there.
Scholarships are there, my people. You shouldn't just sit there and complain, I don't have money to go to school.
Yes.
Have you reached out to that school? So I believe the institutions who actually respond to queries of a student who might want to go there but they don't have the money.
Yes.
I believe institutions will reach out to such students who may be needy and don't have the necessary resources to get themselves there.
Yeah.
One of my younger cousins is watching this morning. He's called Lennox, and he's saying, I think entrepreneurship should be taught from secondary school or even primary school through to university, because there are a lot of things we can do in terms of value addition. Instead of just selling milk, you can make yogurt and ice cream. Mm-hmm. Instead of buying and selling soap, you can manufacture your own soap at home and sell.
Exactly.
And also marketing skills. If one knows how to market an item, even if they can't or are not in a position to manufacture, they can be able to sell any product.
Yeah.
Hey, Lennox, apo mwongea points mingi. Good job. And I love that this is such a young guy and he's alive to the fact that entrepreneurship skills are necessary for every individual.
Exactly.
And is that something that you strive to do as an institution, regardless of what field you are studying? you need to know how to do business,
yes,
whether you are employed or you're going to go to business.
Yes, at Fisher Focus Caterton College, there are two cut-across courses, mm-hmm, no matter what you're doing. Basic computer skills and entrepreneurship.
Mm-hmm.
Because as we've seen, you need to have a basic computer for you to be able. Online marketing is becoming, it's becoming the norm of
what?
The day. You can shop for your shoes,
yeah,
your dress and whatever when you're sitting there.
Mm-hmm.
So if a youth has the skills in online marketing and basic computer skills,
mm-hmm,
then it's good to go. Then entrepreneurship skills, because they normally say, people who can never take risks will always work for people who can.
Yeah.
And those are entrepreneurs. Even investing 100 bob in selling eggs, that is taking a risk, isn't
mm-hmm
it? So if you teach them, we train them how to make risks and get into business, then we are making billionaires of the future.
Absolutely.
Yes.
And I love the fact that we need to understand what value addition is. Just because you are in the business of one, as Lennox clearly puts it here, does not mean that you limit yourself to that. Look at other ways that you can make the most of where you are. Mm-hmm. So as we bring this conversation to a close, maybe what would be your message to all the young people who are watching us this morning, struggling with unemployment, struggling with opportunities that they seem are not available to them? And if the opportunity is available, how to make the most of it?
My message today would be, there's always enough for those who look for it.
Mm-hmm.
Opportunities are there. What we need is to start and promise ourselves that we can do it. Positive thinking is the way to get these opportunities. It doesn't matter the situation we're in now, but if you're a positive thinker,
mm-hmm,
even the negative, even the barriers will become opportunities. Thank you very much, Jen.
All right. There you have it. Mwende Mutua, the director of Future Focus Catering College. Maybe you could remind us your social handles once more. Our young people can interact with you.
You can find Future Focus Catering College at our Facebook page, which is Future Focus Catering College. Our Instagram is also Future Focus Catering College. And our Twitter handle is at Catering for Future. Thank you.
All right. Felix Otieno saying, my youth tuamuke, don't just wait for everything to be done for you. Be your first cheerleader, champion yourself through and through. That brings us to a close of this particular conversation, but we are not done with Good Morning Kenya. More coming up after this breather. Do stay with us. Maybe you had to take a break because we are awesome like that. But we are going to be having a quick look at how our roads are looking like this morning. Ndorin?
Yes, it is that time where we need to see what is happening on our roads in terms of traffic. Try to see if things have opened up a bit or is still the same situation. And also try to look at some new other better alternative routes for our viewers. Just as I mentioned, today we are focusing on Jogoro. There was heavy gridlock early morning hour, but at least things opened up a bit in the second league. So let's try to see how things are looking as of now, or it's just how it is, rather, as how it was. You know, you can remember probably a much earlier. It looks like things have changed altogether, and not for the better at all, just for the worse. That's why it's very important for us to look at some alternative routes, and I'll be showing you some of them, you know, as we move along. But this is how it is looking like right now as you leave the city stadium roundabout there. Coming all the way, this is actually as you leave city, CBD also, coming all through via Jogoro as you branch off to the Donholm roundabout there, heading all the way to Mombasa Road, as well as just heading over to the estates on that particular route, and also branching off to Manyanja Road and going all the way through as you, you know, just using Outer Ring Road, given the fact that also this particular road which you're looking at today is one of those roads that branches off from the major Outer Ring Road. We haven't seen a lot of ongoing roadworks on this particular route or this road, unlike what you've seen on, you know, major roads or even other slip roads such as Manyanja Road coming all the way, and also Feather Road there. On this particular one, there hasn't been a lot of ongoing roadworks, but even at that, there's still heavy kind of traffic. And just to recap for our viewers, the reason as to why there's heavy traffic on this route, given the fact that we haven't seen a lot of roadworks, because part of the reason as to why we would witness heavy kind of gridlock on either major roads or slip roads is simply because there's a lot of ongoing road activities in regards to either rehabilitating of roads, expanding of this road, just to make it easy for pedestrians as well as, you know, those using both private as well as public vehicles. On this specific one, there hasn't been any of that, but even at that, there's still heavy kind of traffic, and this
is the reason as to why. Jogo Road is one of those roads where there's numerous kind of aces. I mentioned that earlier. So ultimately, that is the reason as well. There's heavy kind of traffic, oftentimes, especially in the early morning hours or even evening rush hours. And aside from that, there's a lot of businesses. I can tell you for sure, small-scale businesses, especially along this route. And this is, again, on both lanes, quite a number of them. If you're someone who uses this route, then you can bear witness as to that. And ultimately, that also is a reason as to why there's heavy kind of traffic. And also, there's a lot of bus terminals here and there also along this route. Now, coming back to the traffic flow, it just is as how it was. You can remember a few minutes ago when we were beginning to look at how this road was doing in terms of traffic. And specific again to that lane that is coming to CBD, earlier on, at least, you know, there was a bit of a traffic as you come from the city steady roundabouts, coming all the way via Jogo Road before you get to branch off to the other side of Manyanja Road, heading all the way to Donholm, as well as also branching off as you head to Mombasa Road there. But things have opened up a bit, and it's just how I keep saying all the time that traffic changes every single second. At least as of now, it is green on that particular lane as you leave city center, as you leave CBD coming all the way, and also as you leave Lusaka Road, branching through the roundabout there and joining to the other side of Jogo Road. On that section there, green all through, which is a clear indicator that traffic is not there, just moving at a really, really fast pace. However, just next to, as you get to the Uchumi supermarket there, again, traffic begins to slightly build up there. On the other section, or better still, on the other lane, as you leave the areas of Donholm, leaving the areas of Fadha, leaving Mombasa Road, leaving Outer Ring, leaving Juja Road, leaving Manyanja Road as well, coming through via the roundabout there, as you begin to just come through Jogo Road, heading all the way to the CBD, that's just where there's heavy, heavy kind of traffic. And I want us to check that route again, try to see if at all still could serve as a good alternative route for our viewers, those using this route, or even at all if you are intending to use Jogo Road today. And this is the Isili Fast Avenue. Also, part of the reason why we look at this route as one of those alternative routes is because it's one of those instrumental and good alternative routes if at all you are applying Jogo Road, because this specific route comes all the way where you just get to branch off. If you are coming to CBD, is branching off, you know, past Isili there, Isili Estate, coming all the way via Juja Road, coming all through next to Karioko Market, and there you'll be at the in CBD. So that means if you are coming from Jogo Road this morning and you are not yet past, let's look at that area. This is if you're not yet past the roundabout there, then you can use that as your alternative route. Coming all the way with that same route, branching off just to Juja Road on that section, and you can clearly see just from our map this morning is that it is green all through. And on this specific route, when I'm saying green all through, it just simply means as you leave the roundabout there, which is the first avenue you go roundabout, coming all the way through Isili Estate, branching off to Juja Road there, and also just leaving Juja Road, coming through the Isili Fast Avenue, going all through before you get to that roundabout there. So that's just where there's green all through, ultimately meaning you can use that as your good alternative route. Also, there's been a lot of activities along the Isili Fast Avenue. I'll be telling you all about that in a short while, but at least as of now, this is how the road looks like in terms of traffic along Jogo, which has been our focus this Tuesday.
Wagwan. In case you're just joining us, Karibu Sana, this is Good Morning Kenya. I'm Jane Wumboy, and I am thoroughly appreciating your feedback in regards to the conversation that we just had about the opportunities that are there for our youth. And I have Dan Lugosi on Twitter who's saying, tell the government to change Kenya Power from a profit-driven entity, reduce power and fuel taxes so that other big manufacturers can make a comeback here in our country. And consequently, youth will get employed. All are not cut for business. All right?
We also have Lil Baby KE saying, would you all agree that in the future most of the careers are going to be automated, so the people who succeed will have to be curious, innovative, with resilience to adapt to changes, opportunities, because opportunities never come on a silver platter. Keep up with the changing times. Don't just sit there and complain that the water around you is rising and you are not rising to the occasion. Keep up with the changing times. And again, the government, yeah, we need to look at some of these entities and just look at how they are run, to move from it all being profit driven and look at how they can be able to accommodate other manufacturers that would go a long way in providing opportunities for them youth. Keep talking to us. Again, the hashtag is Good Morning Kenya on Twitter. At KBC Channel 1 ever remains to be the official station handle. My handle is Jane Mumboy across all the social media platforms, so do keep sending in your views, but we'll be addressing them as they come in. So right now we want to switch gears. From matters of women at the forefront, we now want to go to the next conversation, and this is our health segment for today. And we are going to be talking about the general management of diabetes. And to help us with this conversation, we have with us in studio this morning Dr. Nicola Okech, who is, I'm going to say this slowly, lest my roots start showing, endocrinologist. She is an endocrinologist working with Mfisha Hospital. Karibu sana.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for making time to be with us this morning. Mm-hmm. Are you on social media?
Yes and no.
Yes and no. Tricky ground.
<Yes. laughs>
All right. When you're ready to share, you will share with us.
Okay.
So again, this is a health conversation. Diabetes is slowly becoming a silent crisis here in our country, and not just in our country, but the world over. But what are we doing to manage it? And even before we get to the management part of it, what preventative measures are we putting in place for ourselves? And that is what we just want to discover today together. Again, we are here to learn. So questions, comments, clarifications, shoot them through. We will be addressing them with Dr. this morning. So let's start with the big word. Endocrinology. Mtu akisikia hiyo anafikiria endometriosis. What other endos are there? So there's somebody called endo. As in, we all have our own definitions or schools of thoughts of what diabetes falls under. But endocrinology, what is it about?
Well, endocrinology basically encompasses all disorders that are related to hormones, mm-hmm. diabetes being one of them.
Yes.
Endo essentially in medical terms means within, mm-hmm. and endocrine means a hormone-producing organ. So endocrinology is basically the study of hormone-producing organs, mm-hmm. and the diseases that are associated with them.
All right. Yeah. You're in biology at high school, so in case you had forgotten, refer back to high school biology. All right, love that. Very simple to just help us better understand what that big term is. So we are done with that big term. So don't start wondering why we're talking about diabetes under endocrinology. So maybe we could get to even understand your journey to getting to where you are. What is it that made you gravitate towards this particular practice?
I have always enjoyed complex things.
Yeah.
And right from medical school undergraduate, mm-hmm. in fact, I remember specifically during my third year,
yes,
there was a lecturer, and she's actually one of the people who we work in close association with, mm-hmm. at the Mpisha. She's called Dr. Acharya. She actually really inspired me,
yes,
to focus more on endocrinology. Of course, there was a bit of confusion as
along the journey.
Yes, you want to do this, you want to do that.
Yeah.
But eventually, when I did my postgraduate, which was in internal medicine, I did love endocrinology. Mm-hmm. So when I went to subspecialize, it was just natural for me to have chosen that as my line of specialization.
Yes. He did to the call.
Yes.
Now, let's not get to this whole conversation about diabetes. Mm-hmm. Let's start with the actual definition and the types of diabetes that are there, again, for the benefit of our viewers who are watching us this morning.
Okay, diabetes is a spectrum of disorders, but the underlying problem, what we call pathology, mm-hmm. is an inability to control your blood sugars.
Okay.
So basically we divide them into three broad categories.
Mm-hmm.
There is type 1, there is type 2, and what we refer to as gestational diabetes,
mm-hmm.
which is diabetes that occurs in pregnancy. Mm-hmm. Of course, in medicine, we know there are a few other subclasses, but in general terms and for a layman, we would subdivide them into three main classes.
Into those three main categories. Mm-hmm. Now, from where you sit, just interacting with the different patients that you do on a daily basis, how are we doing in terms of the... it being a concern in the medical space here in our country, diabetes as a general condition?
Not good.
We're not doing well.
We're not doing well.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, you don't actually just look at diabetes itself. There's a condition that we refer to as pre-diabetes,
mm-hmm.
which is just before diabetes.
Is that like pre-exposure to some sense of layman language?
Pre-before.
Okay.
So you're not normal,
mm-hmm.
and you're not diabetic, but you're just somewhere there in between. You're at risk of moving to diabetes if you don't take care of yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So there are so many people who come to me with abnormal blood sugars. They're not in the range of diabetes, but you know, of course, this patient is at risk of getting diabetes 3, 5, 10 years down the line.
Mm-hmm.
So at that point, even maybe before the pre-diabetes, you really have to start watching your lifestyle.
Yeah.
So in terms of our control, as a population, we are not doing well. And I see it a lot in the young population.
And that brings me to now that predisposing aspect of it. What are some of those factors that are putting us at risk? And I like the fact that you've mentioned age, because the age is clearly an indicator, or from what you're seeing, the age groups that we are seeing that are exposed are the youth. Why is it so? Why do you think it is the youth that are, from what you're seeing, so many that are coming to you that are at risk of getting diabetes?
Okay. Everything in medicine, we take a two-prong approach.
Mm-hmm.
So it's genetics and your environmental exposure.
Okay.
So in genetics, of course, you have to look at how your genetic pool is. We always ask our patients, is there someone in your family who has diabetes? If they have diabetes, which kind of diabetes do they have? And most of the time we find that those who have a genetic predisposition, they will have someone in their family with type 2 diabetes. Type 2 actually has a stronger genetic predisposition than type 1 diabetes.
All right.
Okay. So then we move on to environmental exposure.
Before we get there,
sure.
I know somebody's going to ask, you've mentioned type 2 being... having a higher chance for genetic, it being passed genetically.
Mm-hmm.
Now let's just define type 1 and type 2 for clarity purposes.
Okay.
Yes.
So type 1, the patient completely lacks insulin.
Mm-hmm.
There's an organ in the body that just sits right above the liver called the pancreas, and this is the organ that tends to produce insulin.
Mm-hmm.
Insulin is involved in the body's handling of glucose.
Okay.
So in patients with type 1, the organ is almost completely destroyed such that it's unable to produce the insulin that it requires to mm-hmm. deal with the blood sugar surges that occur because of eating
mm-hmm.
and just as generally. So type 1 diabetics lack insulin.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not able to control their blood sugar. Consequently high sugar levels. In type 2,
mm-hmm.
they might have the insulin because their pancreas is functioning,
mm-hmm.
but they have insufficient levels. Or alternatively, they have the sufficient levels, but their body is resistant to it.
Mm.
So the resistance comes more so in patients who are obese,
mm-hmm.
especially with what we call the central obesity around the stomach area.
Yeah.
So that's the difference between type 1 and type 2 diabetes.
And consequently, in type 2, low sugar levels.
No, still high,
uh-huh.
because your body, though it has the insulin, it's not sensing it. It's not sensing the insulin.
Or in the bloodstream in itself.
And so it's not able to send those
mm-hmm.
signals to the body to bring down the blood sugar.
Okay.
So the sugar still remains high.
All right.
Yeah.
And you had also mentioned a third category, and this is gestational diabetes.
Yes.
And this is specific
yes.
to expectant mothers.
Yes.
What brings it about?
Genetic predisposition.
Ah.
Yeah. Most of the time it's genetic predisposition. And then, of course, your body weight,
mm-hmm.
your BMI. Yeah.
All those come into play when
all
it comes
come
to gestational
play.
Diabetes.
Yes. Yes.
Now, going back to where we were, issues to do with age, because one would think the younger you are, the less chances you would have of exposure, and especially to diabetes. But then again comes in those issues that you've mentioned, and that number one is lifestyle.
Mm.
What are those aspects of lifestyle that you think, from a medical point, contribute to adding to the risk for the younger people especially?
Okay, just going back, being young is not, it's not a safety measure for you not to develop diabetes. Of course, the older you get, the more likely you are to get.
But the younger you are, you know, your body is able to put up a fight.
Exactly.
As opposed to when you're older.
Yeah. Uh-huh. But you see, we are adopting the Western kind of lifestyle. Mm-hmm. We are eating more of the refined foods, the junk foods.
Yeah.
We are less active. Most people sit at their offices. They go to work in their car. They sit from 9 to 5. They mm-hmm. come back home. They shower maybe and eat and enter
eat and
bed.
Go to bed.
So really, it's a sedentary kind of lifestyle. There's no physical activity.
Mm-hmm.
And those are some of the things that we counsel our patients to incorporate more of, moving about,
mm-hmm.
so that they can be able to manage this condition.
All right.
Or prevent it.
Absolutely. Lifestyle is definitely something that we're going to be diving deeper. But first, we take a very quick break. Keep sending your questions in regards to this conversation about diabetes, sampling them after this break. Stay with us.
Kwenye quickbit.co.ke, siku ya leo ni Samsung A51.
Oh yes, na ni rahisi sana. Unaenda kwenye Lipa na Mpesa. Paybill number ni 403-2353. 403-2353. Account ni SM. Iyo ndiyo kodi ambayo ya Samsung. SM. Fuatanisha na unique number ile unafil. Alafu weka amount 20 bob peke yake.
Ekelea pin yako na hivyo ndivyo utakuwa umekelea bid kwenye quickbid.co.ke. Kumbuka ni bidhaa bora zaidi kwenye bei ya nini?
Chini kwa chini. Chini kwa chini.
Jiunga na QuickBid ni rahisi. Enda kwenye M-Pesa, bonyeza paybill, kisha weka business number 403-2353. Kwenye account, weka kodi ya bidhaa unayotaka na bidi yako ya chini zaidi. Kwa mfano, TV16. Kisha weka shilingi 20 tu kama idadi yako. Weka bidi yako pia kwenye www.quickbid.co.ke. Kumbuka, bidi ya chini zaidi ya kipekee ndio ununua. QuickBid, bidhaa bora kwa bei ya chini.
Malaria ni ugonjwa hatari sana unaoua watu wengi hapa Kenya. Japo kuko na corona, hatari ya malaria bado iko. Mtoto huyu alikuwa na joto jingi, kutetemeka, kuumwa na viungo na uchovu. Alikimbizwa hospitali ya umma ambako sheria za COVID-19 huzingatiwa na ni salama kwa shughuli ya upimaji. Vipimo vilionyesha kuwa ana malaria na papo hapo daktari akampa dawa za malaria na kumshauri azimalize na ili kujikinga wawe wakilala ndani ya neti iliyotibiwa. Malaria husambazwa na mbu. Walio hatarini ni watoto wa chini ya miaka 5 na akina mama wajawazito. Kupimwa na kutibiwa ni bure katika hospitali zote za umma. Usisahau adui malaria. Zero malaria huanza na mimi. Chukua jukumu leo. Komesha malaria. Ujumbe huu umeletwa kwenu na Wizara ya Afya.
The stage is set for the next football star from Africa to emerge at the Under-20 Africa Cup of Nations. Watch all the games live on KBC Channel 1 as 12 countries battle out for the ultimate prize of becoming champions of Africa. Raw talent, raw skills, ultimate technique. From Africa's finest and capped talent, witness footballing dreams come alive at the Under-20 Africa Cup of Nations from 14th of February to 6th of March 2021, live from Mauritania and exclusively on KBC Channel 1, your true sports partner.
Thank you.
Welcome back. We keep on with this conversation. Patrick Kahonge and Stanley Wambogu, thank you so much for staying with us. This is Good Morning Kenya. I'm Jane Wambui, and we are having our health conversation today. And we are just looking at how we can manage diabetes. But before we get to managing, what are we doing to prevent? But let's get and to understand what causes it, to do how to prevent, and if prevention will not work, how we manage that. Okay, this is Class 101. Hashtag Good Morning Kenya on Twitter, at KBC Channel 1, and at Jane Wambui is how you can reach me this morning. In studio once again, we have with us Dr. Nicola Oket, who is an endocrinologist working with M. Fisher Hospital. Thank you so much for still being with us this morning. So now we want to continue just trying to look at some of those factors that expose us, rather predispose us to diabetes. And we've talked about age being something that we actually do have a role to play. This is very individual. So age shouldn't be something that you use as a defense. Now, age and lifestyle all go hand in hand. Let's talk about weight issues. It is one of the biggest reasons that I have seen that brings about diabetes. But from a medical standing, what role does weight have to play in line with predisposing one to diabetes?
Of course, the more weight you have, the more resistance to insulin you have, and therefore the higher likely chance that you are to develop diabetes, more likely type 2 diabetes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How does that work? How is it that you're not able to, is it produce insulin?
No, it's sensing insulin.
Sensing insulin.
Yeah.
What is the barrier that comes into play, scientifically speaking, to just understand how that plays out?
Well, insulin usually has to send various signals to your body so that you can be able to handle the sugar. Mm-hmm. And if you have a lot of fat, mm-hmm. that prevents the insulin from being sensed by mm-hmm. the body, and therefore sending the signals for your body to absorb the glucose.
All right. And do you have to be extremely overweight or just over your regular or recommended BMI?
Over your BMI. Uh-huh. But we also find people with diabetes who are within the BMI. Uh-huh. Yeah. So it doesn't necessarily mean that if you're lean, you'll not get diabetes.
Okay.
Yeah.
This goes back to also the genetic predisposition that could be there.
True.
All right. Now, another issue that you had mentioned earlier on is in regards to hormonal imbalances and it all originating under the endocrine larger group. What role does hormonal imbalance have to play in line with predisposing you to diabetes?
In what sense? Sorry.
I find so many women, or rather from what I was reading online, you find women with hormonal imbalances tend to be exposed to diabetes or have diabetes, and I struggle to understand where the relationship comes in. What is the relationship therein?
Well, most endocrine conditions, hormonal problems tend to be related, and mm-hmm. I think what you're referring to is what we call PCOS,
yes.
Polycystic ovarian syndrome.
Yeah.
So that one, of course, one of the things that it's associated with mm-hmm. is insulin resistance.
Okay.
And of course, if you have resistance to insulin, you're more likely to present with diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then, of course, there are other hormonal issues or endocrine disorders that put you at a higher likely chance of getting diabetes. Mm-hmm. One of them is what we call Cushing's disease, where you have very high levels of cortisol. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, you're also unable to control the amount of glucose that is within your body.
Mm-hmm.
So most of the endocrine conditions are tend to be very related. So if you find one, you'll always tend to look for another.
Uh-huh.
And most of the time, we tend to look for diabetes.
That yes. could be underlying.
Yes.
Now, so that brings in the whole aspect of gender. Does gender have any effect or role to play when it comes to exposure to diabetes, looking at ladies and our gents on the other side of the divide?
Mm-hmm.
Is there one gender that is, from what you have seen, a medical standing, has a greater chance of exposure?
Not really.
Mm-hmm.
The risk is equal, 1-to-1.
1-to-1.
Yeah, it's equal.
1-to-1.
Mm.
All right. Race.
Mm-hmm.
According to research, there's this general voice that those of African descent or native descent are at a higher risk of exposure than of Caucasian descent. Is that true? It's from a medical standing.
It's true. Blacks tend to have a higher chance of getting diabetes. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately for us, we also don't know the specific statistics, especially in our African setting, because we don't do a lot of studies. Mm-hmm. You know, like in our setting, one in every two people with diabetes does not know that they have diabetes. So people are walking around with high sugars and they don't know. Most of the time we get patients who come to us already with complications. And even in evaluating that is when you find that the patient actually has diabetes.
Wow.
Yeah.
Again, it being a silent pandemic that we are seeing. Wow. Now, let's go to the symptoms that, you know, people come with, but they don't really know until things are becoming, things, and it's too late. Mm-hmm. So let's talk a bit about some of those symptoms that could clearly be pointing out that there could be a problem, and more specifically diabetes, but we're not paying attention to. And I'd like for you to explain to us, looking at the differences between type 1 and type 2. Go for it.
Okay. So diabetes symptoms are very non-specific, and there's no one particular symptom that will tell you you have diabetes. It's usually a combination of symptoms.
Okay.
In medicine, we refer to the symptoms as osmotic symptoms, meaning that they lead to a lot of loss of water. So one of the symptoms that we describe is you feel thirsty all the time, taking in a lot of water, you're always thirsty, drinking a lot. Then, of course, as you drink more water, you urinate a lot.
Yeah.
So you tend to pass urine a lot, you'll wake up at night to go to the loo, which is not may not be normal for you. And then of course increased appetite, because your body handles is interpreting that you're not getting enough calories because your glucose is not going into the cells. But in actual fact you have a lot of glucose circulating in your system, but your body interprets it like you're starving, so you'll eat a lot. And then of course non-specific other symptoms, like you feel fatigued, some people will lose a lot of weight because they are losing calories through the urine. So those are some of the symptoms that we look for. When a patient comes with a combination of this, then we'll start to suspect that the patient has diabetes. And then of course you'll also look for symptoms which are related to the complications. So issues with their eyes, is their visual blurring, okay, is there numbness or tingling in the hands or the feet or a burning sensation? So those are the things we ask about.
Are there those that gain weight as a result of the eating constantly because you feel hungry?
Yeah, there's the risk of that also, gaining weight, because if your appetite is increasing, definitely you're storing more calories. Yeah.
Now, there's also this, at least for those who have already gotten to a stage where it's fully fledged diabetes, it hinders the healing process of the body. How does that play out?
It's related mainly to the blood vessels, because high blood sugar interferes with the way the blood vessels function, and the blood vessels carry oxygen and nutrients to wounds. So if the blood vessel is destroyed, they'll obviously be impaired healing. Yeah, and that's what happens in diabetes, mainly because of the sugar interfering with the integrity of the vessels.
Wow, so it's just one problem leading to another one. It's a chain of very tiny problems that at the end of the day put together this bigger picture. Now let's talk a bit about gestational diabetes and just understand the complications that may arise as a result. First of all, for our expectant women who are watching us this morning, at what stage of your pregnancy are you supposed to get screening, at least for gestational diabetes?
Okay, I think we'll just have to clarify, there are people who already have diabetes and then they get pregnant. We always advise the ladies who have diabetes, if at all they anticipate or want to get pregnant, they have to make sure that their blood sugar is well controlled. But there's also this category of women who develop diabetes during their pregnancy. They have not known that they have diabetes. But it's exclusively occurs during the pregnancy. Fortunately for us, in our antenatal clinics and in our antenatal programs in the country, at 24, between 24 and 28 weeks of gestation, every pregnant mother or every expectant mother is supposed to undergo screening for abnormalities in their blood sugar. So they all of them have to undergo that. And if the gynecologist, or obstetrician detects an abnormality in their result, then they usually send them over to the endocrinologist.
Now, how is it managed during pregnancy? At least for someone who's watching us this morning and they have been getting a certain type of management, just to feel reassured that they are getting the proper management of their diabetes during the pregnancy. What are some of those things that need to be or are standard for management during pregnancy?
As always, lifestyle. Mm-hmm. So, of course, what you're consuming, what you're eating, and then, of course, your physical activity. Just because you're pregnant does not preclude you from doing some exercise.
Yeah.
Then, of course, there's the medication. Pregnancy itself, not all drugs used to treat diabetes are safe in pregnancy or even in breastfeeding. We have a very narrow range of medications we can use. So if a patient has previously been diabetic and they have been taking tablets, there are some tablets we can continue to use. Not all of them, some. But if a patient develops the diabetes during pregnancy, we prefer to go straight to insulin injection because we know that will optimize, because what we're trying to prevent is a poor outcome for the mother and for the baby.
And what are the consequences of this gestational diabetes if left unmanaged and unchecked?
Abnormalities in the baby's development. Okay, so they'll probably be born with malformations, okay? Things, problems with the spinal cord, with the brain, with the heart, okay? And then, of course, there's the risk of loss of the pregnancy, okay? So early loss of pregnancy is also a risk. And then if the pregnancy progresses till time of delivery, there's also the chance that you can deliver a very delivering a very big baby, there's the risk of injuries to the child during delivery, injuries to the mother during delivery, even as far as death for both mother and child. Yes.
Just from something that can be managed. And can gestational diabetes continue to exist post the pregnancy, or in most cases, once the pregnancy is done, your body is able to control the sugar levels after the pregnancy?
Usually we'll find that the glucose levels tend to improve once delivery has happened. Some people will go back to being normal. They can handle their sugars normally, but we know that this particular person who has had gestational diabetes is at risk of developing diabetes as compared to someone who has not had. Okay, and then there are also this category of people who will continue to have abnormal sugars even after delivery
as a result of the gestational.
So monitoring is very important after delivery. I know some people get lost to follow up, but even for the gynecologist obstetrician, they need to advise their patients that once you deliver, if you have been diagnosed with gestational diabetes, you need to follow up with that. Regular sugar checks. If you need treatment, then you can be referred to the appropriate specialist.
I know. So mothers, we need to... Clinics post-pregnancy are not just for the baby. Yours are also important in as much as so many people after pregnancy. Clinics are focused on the child. The mother is left to just, you know, take the child, go back home, care for the child. Help yourself. Get checkups. If you don't have a personal doctor, I believe services are made available in most public hospitals to just see how you are doing post-pregnancy. Now, let's go to the management bit of it all. And I'd like to start off with, you know, the gestational diabetes, or even just before we even get to managing gestational diabetes, when it comes to testing for diabetes, how does that happen?
Just a random blood sugar check. That's usually a screening measure. However, we cannot use the random sugar. When I say random, I mean you just walk into the clinic, they check your sugar. You don't necessarily have to have fasted. But that particular sugar, what you call the random sugar, if it is abnormal, we cannot use it to diagnose diabetes. You actually have to recheck it again. Or you now inquire from the patient, do they have the symptoms that are typical of diabetes?
Okay.
The most specific measure would be to probably do what we call a fasting blood sugar, which is the blood sugar test that you do. We tell our patients to come in the morning before breakfast because they should have had an overnight fast of between 6 to 8 hours. Okay. So after supper, nothing in between. That time and the test.
Even water?
Well, water is okay. But yeah, we tell them, I mean, you're not going to wake up to drink water at night. And I mean, unless... Okay, that's
interesting. Okay.
Yeah, so fasting sugar. But there's a specific test that we call the OGTT, which is the oral glucose tolerance test that we tell our patients to go and do. And then that one gives us an indication of, do you lie within the normal range, do you lie within the pre-diabetic, or do you lie at the diabetes range?
Okay.
Because it's always good to identify those people with the pre-diabetes.
Yeah.
Because those are the ones you can target to also prevent them from going to diabetes.
All right.
Yeah.
How often should you have a check done to just check your blood sugars, how often would you recommend one has it done?
If you have a family history of diabetes, it would be advisable to do it in your annual medical checks, mm-hmm. okay? But if you've had like gestational diabetes, especially after delivery, you would do it more frequently. Mm-hmm. Within the 6 weeks, we usually target the mothers at that 6 weeks when they bring their babies to get their vaccinations. Yeah. So we check them then. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, if there's nothing, then we follow them up maybe after 3 months, 6 months, and then yearly after that.
Aye.
But especially for people who are getting older in age, after 40 years, mm-hmm. you tell them to do your annual medical checkups and check
make
for your
sure
blood sugar.
Check on the blood sugar.
Exactly.
And even for those young folk and they don't have their family history, mm-hmm. how often would you recommend, also not looking at gestational diabetes being a problem, mm-hmm. just a regular young person minding their business, mm-hmm. how often would you recommend they have a sugar test done?
Well, if they are lean, they're not obese, mm-hmm. okay, maybe once every 3 years,
okay.
that would be acceptable.
All right,
yeah.
Just get it done.
Mm.
It won't hurt to just mm. know. Most of these things we come to find out when they are blown. Mm-hmm. Now, the management bit of it. Let's start with diet. Mm-hmm. This is something that so many people struggle with, and especially looking at weight. We want to eat the sweet things. We want to eat the processed things. Mm-hmm. Junk food are always already available for everyone.
Mm.
How can we have a diet that is good for us? And it's also delicious to eat. Because again, junk is always good, nitamu, but the consequences are harsh. How can we have a diet that is healthy and delicious and also just safe in terms of sugars?
Well, the diet is always available. It's about the intention to mm-hmm. choose what is right for you.
Yes.
So we always give our patients or people who are looking to adopt a healthy lifestyle the plate model.
Mm-hmm.
So when you look at your plate, provided it's a normal size plate, not something
it is no more side plate,
not the
dinner plate.
well, a reasonably sized brown
okay.
plate. So
yeah.
half of it should be vegetables,
mm-hmm.
okay? And then a quarter should be your starch and a quarter should be your protein.
Mm-hmm.
If you really want to estimate, you can say this: the size of your fist is the size of a quarter, so mm-hmm. size of your protein, size of your starch. Then your both of your palms together should be the size of the vegetable serving that you give yourself.
Okay.
Yeah.
And looking at starches especially,
mm-hmm.
are there those that you discourage? Let me use myself as an example. Mina penda waru,
mm-hmm.
all forms of potatoes
mm-hmm.
in the different shapes and the variants it comes in.
Mm-hmm.
So you find somebody might overeat on one kind of a starch and use it as, you know what, I'm eating starches as I've been recommended.
Mm.
Also balancing the portions and frequency.
Mm.
Does that have a role to play in all this?
Definitely, definitely.
Yeah.
And also when you're advising our patients, we tell them go for more, less refined
mm-hmm.
starches. Avoid the white starches, but we know, of course, those are the ones which we find more available.
My heart.
You get your white ugali, your chapati, you know. So, watch your portions.
Uh-huh.
Watch your portions. I think that should be the take-home message. Watch your portions.
All right.
Yeah.
Exercise.
Mm-hmm.
One might argue, okay, I'm not big, I'm lean,
mm-hmm.
so exercise is not really for me. I'll just mind my diet. Adopting exercise as part of your routine to help with the management and prevention of diabetes.
Mm-hmm.
What would be your advice to this end?
We say 3 to 4 times a week,
mm-hmm.
exercise between 30 to 40 minutes during each session. And then you have to combine both anaerobic and aerobic exercises.
Mm-hmm.
By aerobic, I mean something that will get your heart pumping.
Mm-hmm.
So like jogging, running, a brisk walk, swimming, okay? And then anaerobic are the lifting weights, basically to stretch your muscles, because you have to do, other than your skeletal muscles, you also have to exercise your heart,
mm.
which is a muscle. So that's why the aerobic and anaerobic combination comes in.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I came across hydration as part of the management bit of it. Help us understand how staying hydrated is in line with self-management towards the prevention of diabetes, if it is to start with.
Well, I wouldn't really call it, well, if you mean hydration with water,
yes,
well,
like
then that's acceptable.
Staying hydrated throughout.
Well, I would say from the way I think about it is that the more water you consume, the less hungry you are and the less calories you will consume. So in that way, it curtails the amount of calories you're taking
mm-hmm.
in. Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, self-management education, and this brings in the aspect of insulin, at least for those who have to take them on a daily, and The education bit of it all for those who actually have diabetes and why it is important to know how to self-manage and self-administer insulin. Importance of that.
Self-management is very important because at the end of the day, you're not going home with your doctor, you're not going home with your nurse. So you also have to understand how to manage your own blood sugars. Ideally, when we have a session with our patients, we always tell them the targets of blood sugar that you're aiming for. And targets are individualized. I wouldn't give you the same target that I would give an 80-year-old person with diabetes. So they are always individualized. So it's always important for you to consult with your doctor, and there is always a diabetes nurse educator, we have them in MPSHA, and a nutritionist. So that encompasses the whole aspect of self-management of diabetes.
Yes, you need to know how to manage yourself in the event of anything. You don't suffer harsher consequences. All right. Prime Movers is asking, could Dr. Nicola elaborate on endometriosis?
Endometriosis is a gynecological.
In line with diabetes, if there's any relationship.
No, there is no relation between endometriosis and diabetes.
Okay.
Endometriosis is actually a gynecological problem where there are, I mean, I'm not a gynecologist, but at least I know
the basics.
There's abnormal uterine tissue in other parts of
outside
the body
outside the uterus. Okay.
Yes.
All right. Lil Baby asking, what is the relationship between diabetes and sight loss?
It's a complication of diabetes. What usually happens, because there's an abnormally high blood sugar level all over the body, it includes also the eye. So when there's high glucose, it draws water. Glucose draws water wherever it goes, okay? And the accumulation of glucose in the lens of the eye draws water and makes your sight hazy. Yeah, so that's what happens. That's why you get abnormalities in the vision. And in addition to that, as I mentioned before, it interferes with the blood vessels. So as it interferes with the blood vessels, particularly the small ones, which are also found in the eye, in the kidney, and along your nerves, it will also compromise your vision.
Is it reversible, and especially for the eyesight? Can it be corrected?
Okay, it depends on how severe it is. In the early stages, definitely, but later on, sometimes it might need to sight loss.
All right. Now, as we draw this conversation to a close, maybe if we just take a minute or so to just talk to our viewers when it comes to the importance of being very careful with what we take, because at the end of the day, what we eat is what will determine our exposure to diabetes, and consequently what we can do to prevent it as a whole. Just general message to our viewers this morning.
Yeah, so being conscious of what you're taking in, as you mentioned, try and make it intentional that you pick the right foods. And sometimes it's kind of difficult. I find most of my patients come to me and tell me, oh, you know, doctor, I went for a conference, and you know, I can't control my diet when I go to a conference. But there's that buffet there, and there's this serving of vegetables, and there's this serving of chapatis. You've chosen to take 10 chapatis and leave out the vegetables. So it's about an intentional effort to pick what is right for you. And then, of course, exercise. Everyone should be incorporating some form of exercise according to your ability. So that you keep your body moving.
All right.
Yes.
Jay Kim is asking, just before we close, can a vegan person be exposed to diabetes?
Yes. We have quite a number. We have quite a number of patients who are vegans or vegetarians, and they do have diabetes. So as I mentioned, genetics also plays a role in that. And the older you get, of course, your genetics comes in more.
All right. Thank you so much, Daktari. We have been speaking with Dr. Nicola Okech. She is an endocrinologist working with MPSHA Hospital. This morning, you're helping us to understand what we need to do to manage ourselves. Be your first micromanager. Look at what you are eating, what you're putting into your body, and how it is helping you. Is it good? Is it bad? Or it's ish. If so, decide, because I mean, at the end of the day, diabetes is a lifestyle disease if you do not have any genetic predisposition. So be your first line of defense. Thank you so much for being with us this morning.
Thank you.
We appreciate you for making time.
Asante sana.
All right. Now, we are almost done with Good Morning Kenya, but not before I rope in Kalastbona Ketu. Ndorini.
Yeah.
Wagwan.
So the director decided otherwise. Okay, what we'll do right now, we want to quickly take a look at the rules before we just have a last conversation. And I just want to remind our viewers what you are looking at today. This was Jogod, and I actually just got one of the alternative routes there, because remember, I told you earlier there was heavy traffic. Still is there heavy traffic along this route. So let's see this specific road, which is Bira Road, one of those minor roads branching off from the First Avenue Jogod. So this specific route, as you branch off from that roundabout there, coming just through Isili First Avenue, then you branch off to that route. This is how it is looking like, at least as of now. So why you're seeing that green color actually on both lanes is just a good sign that it's smooth sailing, moving at a very fast pace. And look at how it is looking like. So clearly you can use that as an alternative route as you come all the way to the CBD, which that specific route branches you off to before you get to the city stadium roundabout there. So clearly you can use that as one of the alternative routes. If you're past there, then you can just keep up with the Isili First Avenue going all the way to Juja Road, just as I had mentioned to you earlier. And at least it looks like, you know, what you're looking at right now in terms of that alternative route, not that bad. So yes, in as much as there's that red color there, which again is an indicator that there's really heavy kind of traffic moving at a really slow pace, but at least quite a manageable kind of traffic there, because on the other side, at least it's green all through, meaning there that there's no traffic moving at a really fast pace. Also, I told you earlier that in as much as there hasn't been any ongoing roadworks along this route, which ultimately could be a good reason of the kind of traffic that we're spotting this morning in terms of the heavy kind of gridlock there, it is one of those busy roads in terms of numerous ACEs, in terms of businesses, both medium and small scale kind of business. And this actually goes all the way before until you get to the city stadium roundabout, as well as just coming all the way from Lusaka, branching off to that roundabout, heading all the way through Landis Road as you come to the city center. Heavy kind of traffic there all through and through. That is why we are sporting that maroon color there. But at least we've tried our best to get some alternative routes for our viewers. Those using this route, this is Jogod. If at all you're going about your businesses, any kind of activities to the CBD, or if at all you intend to use this route. So if you're not yet past Uchumi, then you can use the Isili First Avenue as your alternative route. If you're past there, then you can use the Abira Road, which I just showed you, as your alternative route. And at least as of now, that is how the road is looking like in terms of traffic. We've keenly been focusing on what has been happening along Jogod. I also mentioned to you earlier that there has been a lot of works, especially along the Isili First Avenue road. So you clearly want to be sticking around with us just for me to be telling you what has been happening on that route, as well as many other roads in regards to the different projects they are doing. But before we wrap up this show, Wamboi, you've had really amazing conversations, and I really love the end, you know, what we had there when it comes to women at the forefront because of the target on Matters Entrepreneurship. And I just want to pick a quote of what our guest said.
Yes.
That if you cannot take risks by yourself, for yourself, then utakona take risk for somebody else.
Mm-hmm.
It sounded more of like a wake-up call.
Yes.
Because for most of us young people, and especially if you are in employment, there's that tendency to think, you know, it's just employment all the way. But you get to understand, sometimes life is just beyond that space that you're in. Mm-hmm. What are you called to do? What impact are you called to make? And sometimes it could be in business. So you might just want to really explore your options. And also when she was touching about our viewers were asking, how about we also have entrepreneurship classes as early as from high school? Such a beautiful sentiment.
That is important.
Don't you think these are things we need to start incorporating? So that you just don't get out here and what you learned in school, you can't even wrap around what you're finding in the market.
Yes, you know, this mentality, we need to unlearn so many things.
Exactly.
And relearn so many things and learn new things altogether. And if you wait to do that when you are out of school, boss, tutahangaika. But in line with that, hapa naona mtu anajiita Eric ameandika tu lies what? Confirm what your allegations. John N. Onsaki is asking, your position is in regards to what? Please confirm that. But as we draw this conversation to close, kuna Lisa hapa amesema, other ways to prevent diabetes. Number one, avoid drama. Number two, work hard. Number three, keep your body right. Number four, drink your water. And finally, and most importantly, mind your business.
I'm smiling this way because nimekwama hapo kwa drama.
Avoid drama.
Drama could mean so many things.
But we appreciate you guys for sharing with us your views. Hapo hivi kuna mtu ananiuzia account Twitter. Boss, mimi niko sawa na Twitter account yangu.
Niko sawa na watu wanakufuata.
Mimi, I love my people, so keep it moving, keep it pushing. But that's it from me. Thank you so much for being with us this morning. Tupatane tena kesho. I am Jane Mumboi.
Doreen. And I am Doreen Arange. Till tomorrow, good morning.
Another exciting edition of CoverGirl Looks with me, Christine Courier. Most brides want to look perfect on their wedding day, but before the D-Day, you have to go through different trials of hair, makeup, and finding the perfect dress. I made it really, really easy for our bride-to-be, Florence.
Hi, my name is Florence Thairu, and I'm the bridal CoverGirl. I got engaged last year, July, and it was one of the happiest moments of my life. So from then till now, we're in the process of planning the wedding. The ironic thing is that I've actually never tried a wedding dress before. And this is where Christine Courier comes in with the bridal cover girl. She asked me whether I could participate in it, and I was honored and I said yes. And I also thought it would be a great opportunity for me to try on the dresses and just to have a feel of how it would be to be a bride and, you know, with the makeup and the hair. So I'm really excited.
This goes out to all the brides-to-be out there. Before you decide on your hair and makeup look, I'd suggest you go find the dress first. Now, I took Flo to Burlesque Brides for us to get that beautiful dress that will now match with the hair and makeup.
So Christine Courier approached me and told me about this brilliant idea to collaborate with her on the bridal edition. I was really excited because she's all about bringing out the inner beauty of a woman, and this is exactly what we endeavor to achieve at Burlesque Bridal. I am really excited to work with her. On this bridal edition, I brought three gowns. I brought two mermaid gowns and one ball gown, and I can't wait to see Christine work her magic on the hair and the makeup and see the final look.
So you're the master when it comes to bridal dresses. Mm. What would you advise?
You have the perfect body shape. You're petite, so any kind of dress will look gorgeous in you. Mm-hmm. I think I would love to see her in a mermaid dress, mm-hmm. so we can show off her figure, we can show off her curves, mm-hmm. and also a ball gown, so we can, you know, give you that princess look, because you have this nice puffy hair, so the mm-hmm. African princess will really come out and show out.
Wow.
I think that will also look nice. Mm-hmm. And then we can also, with a glam look, we mm-hmm. can do also a mermaid dress.
Nice.
With a lot of drama, with the long tail, the bling bling. Yeah.
What type of dress were you thinking of, like, when you were looking through? I'm sure you've been paging through hundreds of magazines, like all brides do.
Yeah.
Even styles.
Just like she said, because of my small figure, mm-hmm. I really like the mermaid dress, you know, something that's very fitting.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think that's what I really want.
And now it's time for me to work my magic. And this is where I was telling you earlier that it's important for you to first get the dress, because now you can see how each dress can be paired with hair and makeup to match its look. And for this first dress, it was a beautiful, sleek, fitted dress that had diamantes on it. For this one, I decided to go for a sleek updo, and I wanted to give her bun a lot of character. So I used a necklace so that I can add, like, different elements of the pearls to her hair just to add that glamour. It's something that she's never done before. She's never had an updo on her hair because she's got beautiful, long, thick, natural hair.
We added a few extensions onto her hair to add more volume and length. We also provided her with eyelashes to make her eyes pop on her big day, and we wish her the very best on her upcoming wedding.
So to match up her sleek hairstyle and her dress, I went for a more shimmery, glamorous look. For her makeup, I decided to be more playful with color. So I used different shades of purple on her eyes and lips, whilst keeping her skin flawless and glowy, because hey, every bride has to glow on her big day. Second look, she had a whimsical dress, and the hair and makeup had to match with that. For her hair, I decided to let her natural hair out and give her this beautiful accessory on the side so that she can just look extra with the accessory. And for her makeup, I added a pop of a dark purple lip color just to add more spice to the look. Now this is my favorite look on Flo. She looks absolutely stunning. We did some romantic curls on her hair. She has on this beautiful lace dress. I love it. What do you think? We had so much fun with Florence, and I am so sure she's confused which look to go for her big day. Now, if you're bride-to-be, please note, it's important for you to try on different hairstyles and makeup styles and even dresses before your big day so that you can be very confident walking down the aisle. Until next time, thank you for watching CoverGirl Looks with me, Christine Correa.
Is a young Kenyan judoka and has been playing since he was 5 years old. Now at the age of 12, he has been involved in quite a number of competitions, as he tells us.
Nimefanya competition kadha kama Rongai, KDF, Nakuru, Malindi, na Prison.
Being in school, he has to balance between school and training. So how does he manage to do it?
We want to train judo. Every weekday, we want to end school Monday to Friday.
Katana shares with us some of his high moments in the game of judo.
I was Malindi na Nakuru. I was enjoyable. I was able to play the machine. Ilikuwa kwanza cadet juniors. Ilikuwa namba moja na nikasaidia Westlands judo.
What about some of his lowest moments?
Tushikenye ilikuwa Rongai. Niliana nikapata wachezaji wametrain hard. Sikia sikuwa na bidii sana hivyo. Ilikuwa ni mara ya kwanza. Sasa ndio nikaona niendelea keep over, push. Naweza pia mimi nikuwe kama wao.
Being from a humble background, support to go to all these competitions comes in handy. So what kind of support does he get?
Napata support kwa coaches wetu. And who wana sponsor. Nikienda competitions, yeah, who wana ni manage, kunilipia games, kuenda matrip. hizo trip zote ni yeye huwa na keep over mimi naenda.
His coach Tom started this judo club to help kids from humble backgrounds get involved in the sport and also to keep them busy to avoid ill behaviors that might be brought about by idleness.
Well, training upcoming judokas is I find it's very fun because you know they're the people that we expect that will take over from us. And if you base yourself on the young ones, then you know that you have not killed judo. The judo will still come and it will continue. So that's why I find it interesting to put all the effort on the young and promising and coming judokas. And also still, it makes them, have something to do on Saturdays. You know, because we start, 1 o'clock. And instead, when they finish their schools, they come here, they have something to do, they make friendship. So by itself, it's not only judo, but it's also it's like come together with meeting people, sitting together, talking after judo, because they have to talk, they have to make friendship. So that's why I find it interesting working with the young ones.
And finally, his advice to young upcoming judokas.
Oh, I'd like to welcome them, tell them, first of all, if I talk to parents, because parents are the ones who are supposed to allow their kids to participate in sports, this is a very good sport for kids, because it's not dangerous, it's very safe. First of all, you start from the basic, and then you develop that, you advance. And I would like to appeal to parents not to keep their kids at home, They have to take their kids outside, involve themselves into various activities, especially judo, because judo is a gentle game, and they will see the big change, because judo changes kids' mind. It builds confidence. It makes the kids, respect others. So it's respect, confidence, and all this kind of stuff.
Katana shares with us his future plans in the sport.
Judo nazataka niendelee nayo hadi sasa hadi nzeke. Nazataka nicheze judo kwa Olympics. Ndio hata pia mimi niko mwalimu.
We at Gemon wish Katana all the best as he practices the game of judo.
Greetings, Massive and crew. Welcome to the Big Bad Show. This is The Rev,
where radio meets TV each and every Wednesday.
Live on KBC Channel 1 and KBC Radio Taifa. Yazimi? This is where we play with the latest and the greatest from homegrown artists to international reggae stars.
Check in The Rave with Junior Dread and DJ Stano
every Wednesday from 10 p.m.
If you blink, you miss the link.
If you ain't going my way.
Daniel Matatu.
Yaani mtu mzima na miaka zake hizo miaka zote. Mtu ajui kujua kuandika note. Note tu peke yake. Eh, kusoma kweli itasaidia.
Yana nita. Nini nakusumbua na mimi?
Nauliza. Ni bwana.
Chupia. It's so okay.
Mama Enjo. Don't you care?
Yeah.
The stage is set for the next football star from Africa to emerge at the Under 20 Africa Cup of Nations. Watch all the games live on KBC Channel 1 as 12 countries battle out for the ultimate prize of becoming champions of Africa. Raw talent, raw skills, ultimate technique. From Africa's finest and capped talent, witness footballing dreams come alive at the Under 20 Africa Cup of Nations from 14th of February to 6th of March 2021. Live from Mauritania and exclusively on KBC Channel 1, your true sports partner.
Tonight on KBC Channel 1.
This is Mrs. Lucrecia Montesinos. I need to see you right away. It must be today.
Don't I just give you my card so that you can call me anytime you want?
Oh, thank you very much.
But didn't you and your mother understand that this is the big opportunity I've been waiting for my entire life?
Don't want to face your feelings. There's nothing I can do, Constanza, but I already did it. And you know what? It felt so good to admit it in front of the whole world.
No, you're not going to get divorced.
Good morning and welcome to Channel One News Check on the 16th day of February 2021. Hope you're having a fruitful morning. It's time for us to check what is happening where you are. And today we will be discussing matter state of politics in the nation and more so on the political divide. We've seen a lot of people and mostly politicians engaging in scuffles and others. And of course, the NCIC has been on hot on their heels, of course, talking about fostering unity in the country. That is exactly what we'll be discussing, because looking at the country now, the political drumbeats keep on sounding better and better each and every day. And unfortunately, the political temperatures are rising with that noise. And joining me in studio are two gentlemen who I'm quite sure will be having a very interesting conversation. On my immediate left, we have Dr. Danvas Makori, who is a National Cohesion and Integration Commission, NCIC Commissioner.
Thank you very much.
And Tom Ojanga, who is a political strategist, and it's always a pleasure having you.
Thank you very much.
Dan, I've never had an opportunity other than for the press conferences to have a one-on-one with you, but thank you, gentlemen, indeed, for coming. We are going to be looking at the political situation in the country, but as well as looking at matters of politics, we've really had so many deaths of great political icons in the country. Kindly, in 1 minute each, we can perhaps touch on that.
I think, yeah, condolences to the Bonchari MP and his family, first of all, and the people of Bonchari for losing the MP, and also for Yusuf Haji and the family. Mm-hmm. I know them personally, work with them. And the people of Garissa and the country at large, I think we've lost, especially Mahaji, a great icon, great man, statesman, made a big difference in this country. And it's true, we've seen a number of them. Yesterday was on Bonchari's funeral. He passed away 2 years ago, I think.
Yeah.
So we're seeing, I think, what we're seeing is a passing away, and for lack of a better word, the new generation of leaders need to rise up to receive the baton from the great leaders that are preceding us, in the Chais and the Hajis. But congrats to them, but hopefully we can learn from them, the strengths and the weaknesses, and we can make a better country.
Indeed. Ojang.
Yeah, first, my condolences to the family of Senator Aji, who has done exemplary work for this country, particularly within the context of the BBI, which he did as his last engagement. Obviously, also the family of the Member of Parliament for Bonchari, and also the Jachais. I think we have a constitutional process for replacing leadership. I mean, naturally, of course, for Nyachai, the baton has been handed over. Same to Senator Haji, the MP for Bonchari, unfortunately, died in the middle of
this time.
So his replacement, of course, will be done according to the law and the process thereof. So I think it's unfortunate to lose a member of parliament right in the middle of his term, because then they have programs and projects that they promised the electorate to execute before the end of their term.
Yes.
But nevertheless, I think the system and the laws that we have, which are quite solid, will take care of that.
Indeed. Away from that, let's now delve into politics. And indeed, you can be part of this conversation, and we always welcome your feedback. Remember, we are live on all our various social media platforms, that is Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and also on our KBC app. Of course, it's going to help you, and especially when you are on the move, or you are somewhere that is not conducive for you to have a television set, you can watch this newscast live and other programs that we have right here on KBC. My name is Ben Troy-Njue, and Lensa Odingo will be helping us in the sign language interpretation. And perhaps to delve into the politics, perhaps what have really happened other than the transition of those political icons, the BBI, of course, the BBI is one of the things that has also risen the political temperatures in the country in the run-up to the 2022 succession politics. And we have the bill that was taken to all the 47 county assemblies. Mm-hmm. Three have already passed, but we saw something that perhaps a lot of Kenyans didn't expect, or a lot of Kenyans expected, because we saw it was shut down in Baringo County. What can you say?
I think the question is not it being shut down. I mean, democracy, they have a right to choose to reject it or reject it. They're representative of the people. But I think it's the way it was done. We saw people exchanging blows.
Yes.
We saw people fighting, men and women, grown women, adults. And these are elected leaders. So I think the issue wasn't just the way it was done. I mean, the minimum threshold is 25. And so it's expected people will reject it. And you have a right to reject it as a county. So may I take issue on how it was done?
Yes.
Secondly, I think the challenge, what I see, is the fact that it is people reject it not on principle or content, but on political expediency. So in other words, if you're opposed to one faction or pro one faction, the counties which will lose to an extent, but because they are aligned to one side, they have to vote for it. So it's not really benefiting them.
Yes.
The country which is really benefiting them a lot, but because they are aligned to one political faction, they reject it. So it's really political expediency rather than content, because the people who benefit out of it, majority of them I think can benefit, will benefit. But so I think we've not elevated ourselves to a sober debate whereby it is policy. Our policy, of course, is not as much weight ought to be. I mean, for goodness sake, we've been independent for over half a century. Mm-hmm. We should have gotten our act together to an extent. So I think our concern is the way it was done. So I'm for decent, okay? argue against it or for it, but for goodness sake, you don't have to fight it. Mm-hmm. You don't have to do underhanded methods. You don't have to use Machiavellian tactics.
Yes.
You understand?
Yes.
To achieve a goal. So basically what we have is a policy which is in itself, it's an end to itself. Mm-hmm. And you know who, and the tragedy, here is a tragedy. And just to finish on this point, the third point, the tragedy is that the people are the ones who suffer.
Yes.
You know, the people are the ones who suffer. If as I see, I just agree that these guys will get their cars, they'll get their car grants. Mm-hmm. You know, but who suffers? It's the people who will suffer in this thing.
Yeah. And Ojanga, as Daktari has rightfully put it, is that the County Assembly of Baringo exercised its democracy, but of course we have an issue on how they did it. We saw chairs flying, kicks, mm-hmm. blows, and of course a couple of weeks ago, I remember NCIC did release a list of shame. Of course, I'm hoping that that clip will be ready so that we may see exactly what NCIC had to say and to warn politicians. But according to what happened in Baringo, what can you say?
I think generally there is a trend in this country in which goons are sponsored to force a particular political direction or political opinion. Mm-hmm. In the case of Baringo, obviously the chaos was masterminded to poke holes in the presidential candidacy of the Honorable Senator Gideon Moi. Mm-hmm. This is unfortunate. I mean, external forces going to the Baringo County Assembly to cause disruption, mm-hmm. to sort of hit the candidate, you know, to poke holes in the candidacy of Honorable Senator Gideon Moi. This is very unfortunate. And I think mm-hmm. the institutions in this country mandated to protect the constitutional democratic order should be called upon to actually act. Your institution, for example, coming from the kind of perspective we always have, we've always had in the last 39 years, the core of the Kano philosophy is peace, love, unity, one nation, one people, which is the foundation, actually, of upon which institutions like NCIC was built and BBI. Mm-hmm. So, and I need to commend the Honorable Senator Gideon Moi because he didn't act. Mm-hmm. You know, he let it be. Mm-hmm. Showed a lot of maturity, a lot of political maturity, a lot of dignity, mm-hmm. and not sponsoring goons to counter that, mm-hmm. which is expected of a leader. Mm-hmm. But nevertheless, I think these are matters that must be addressed mm-hmm. by the institutions that are mandated to do so mm-hmm. going forward, because we want to go towards 2022 in a peaceful manner, mm-hmm. in a manner that is mature, mm-hmm. that actually also goes to cement our cohesion and peace. Mm-hmm. In any case, when you have occurrences like that, the country suffers, the whole country, because capital itself actually fears instability. The signal we're sending by sponsoring goons is that we're not a stable country, and therefore investors are also getting scared, therefore we don't get capital to grow, therefore we cannot develop forward. So these are actions that help to stagnate the economy. It's not just about Gideon Moi, because when something like that happens, mm-hmm. then the world gets to see. Mm-hmm. Then it's about Kenya. It's mm-hmm. not anymore about Baringo. So I think it was very unfortunate, very wrong, and those who did that, sponsored that, should be taken to court.
Talking of taking action, last month NCIC did release a list of shame. Of course, it was welcomed. Other quarters really castigated it. Others said, yes, this is the way to go. I remember some of the names. Of course, we've seen them not only this year. We've seen them like Mike Sonko. We've seen some of the things that he used to do that really didn't foster that unity that we're talking about. Let's first of all listen to that clip as NCIC released a list of shame and, of course, lauded some of the legislators or leaders that we have in the country.
the Kenya's political history. Names of politicians exhibiting bad
for that, but as soon as we rectify that technical problem, we will be getting back to that clip. And in case you just joined us, we're talking about unifying the country, the state of politics in the country. Of course, they haven't been so smooth of late, and the political drumbeats keep on sounding much deeper, and have a bigger noise each and every problem that we have in the country when it comes to politics. But perhaps to respond to that, some people have talked about the list being not conclusive. It was not conclusive. And others talking about, okay, fine, we have the list, then what?
I think first and foremost, let me explain to you why, because the people who criticize it, and rightfully so, and I think it's good in our society to listen to dissenting views, like I said earlier.
Yeah.
Now, for those who are against it, they say, oh, it's just a list, you know, these politicians don't care. Well, actually, they do. Some of them do. Because I can use it, for example, first of all, responded the next day and then threatened to sue us. So if it's not really affecting you, then why are you suing us? You understand?
Yes.
But let me tell you why we did it. And people always focus on the shame part, but also there's a side to it which I actually wanted to focus on.
Yes.
You see, first of all, these people have to be called out. We have a culture whereby the reason this narrative continues, politicians incite and abuse, and this is because it is celebrated. Okay, when Junet said what he said about Mora, which Mora did was wrong in Githurai, people in that meeting were cheering and clapping, and actually thought it was very funny. Okay. The same thing happened when in Sambweni, when the two politicians who actually we summoned to our places, when each was engaging in the rhetoric, the crowds actually were loving it.
And cheering it.
Now, see, sometimes we have to sober up our country, say, guys, this is wrong. And see, we've gone so far at a point whereby when you insult or demean somebody or this disability or ethnic group where they come from, actually people think that is funny and people cheer it. So to say, no, we have to remind them that this is actually wrong. Mm-hmm. So it's an entry point of discussion. Like, we cannot accept it. Because if you reject such things, they will not do it. They pay to the gallery. It's a supply and demand issue here. The reason politicians do that is because people actually expect it. People actually love it. People expect it. Yesterday we had a funeral.
Yes.
A church funeral. Mm-hmm. And for the first time in a big national funeral, there was no politics. I was in a group and in all the groups and with key leaders and your fellow editors were like, tomorrow we don't have headlines. we don't have any headlines tomorrow. Yeah. Why? Because nothing really dramatic happened. Yeah. Nothing bad happened that excites people. We want that. People were watching. People tuning the TVs to wait and see. Yes. Like, we want to see more drama.
More drama.
You understand?
Yeah.
So the reason we did that is because, guys, this is just wrong. And guess what? After doing it, if you realize, people have kind of toned it down. Politicians and we were adamant, especially in funerals. Our state, especially funerals. Families should not allow politics in funerals. If you are invited to something, condole with the family, say a story about the departed, and sit down. Uh-huh. And these guys listened to what we were saying. Uh-huh. So it is that's why we did it. Okay. Secondly, we said actually clearly, if you appear there numerous times, actually, you'll be disbarred from running from office. Now, uh-huh. People who are saying, well, it's another here, another there, I can tell you it is there, because chapter 6 is very clear.
Yes.
Okay, understand? Uh-huh. And we created a multi-agency task force, uh-huh. together with the ACC, the IBC, the DCI, okay, uh-huh. that actually will be vetting these guys. So actually, it has consequences. Why? Uh-huh. Because the only thing that our local politician fears, you see, anywhere in the world, politicians fear to be arrested. Okay, anywhere in the world. Mm-hmm. I mean, just actually, not even a scandal, a whiff of scandal. Mm-hmm. If you're caught texting something inappropriate,
yeah.
you resign.
You resign, yeah.
You understand?
Yes.
Here, no. If you kill somebody, you're celebrated.
You get to
the
head.
You shoot somebody, yes. So if you arrest somebody, you know, we arrested a leader.
You're saying this is partly Kenyan's fault.
No, let me show you where I'm coming from.
Yeah.
When you arrest people, we summoned somebody, one of our leaders in the Northeast, and I want to mention who, uh-huh. and the opponent,
came to me and said, why did you guys arrest him? Why are you summoning him? Because when you do that, you're giving him mileage on the ground.
Yes.
You make him more popular. You understand?
Yes.
So this is where it's coming from. So the only thing politicians fear is not being arrested, mm-hmm. not being summoned. They don't care, they even to be taken to court. They don't fear that. The only thing they fear is the election part, the electorate, them being rejected. So what we can do is deny them that opportunity. Mm-hmm. Like, okay, you know what? If you really want to go that way, yeah. you don't fear getting arrested. You know, okay. Thirdly, to why that was on the other part, the whole of fame, the list of fame.
Yes,
there are people who are doing excellent.
Yeah.
When there's opportunity to incite, uh-huh. they're not inciting. They're doing the opposite. They're going out of their way to really make sure the country is cohesive, especially in sensitive areas
yes.
like Njoro. Bruno Nakuru is the tinderbox when it comes to political violence.
Yes.
And then the leadership in Nakuru, uh-huh. not just the one we listed, which you have a point where you said the list was not comprehensive.
Yes.
I agree with you.
Yes.
And next month we'll publish more. Mm-hmm. But the leadership in Nakuru, the not just the Gadambi, Liz Chelude, the women rep, yes. Kihika, mm-hmm. the senator, mm-hmm. I think Imani, mm-hmm. In Molo,
yes.
This is a gentleman for Bahati.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the deputy speaker, I mean, they did a fantastic job, and they've gone out of their way, really, regardless of where they stand politically. When violence came, mm-hmm. they were forthright, they were upfront, they went on the ground, they spoke to make sure there's peace. Same thing that we listed again. So, mm-hmm. to us, what we're saying is, listen, mm-hmm. this is wrong, but also we are saying, hey, this is what you can emulate. This is what standard it can be. You can actually do the right thing because there are many leaders actually doing the right thing mm-hmm. in the face of an opportunity to incite.
Mm-hmm. And perhaps you can comment on that. Something also we saw, and especially during the barrier for Kisi deputy governor, mm-hmm. as father, the fight, the Silvana Sosko and the Simba Arati.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody noted that, unfortunately, when the two leaders stood to talk, that is Deputy President William Ruto and former Premier Raila Odinga, they never castigated
true.
What just happened.
Very true.
They never touched anything on the same, but perhaps you can respond to that.
You know, there's a culture that has been developing in this country, and to some extent, the media also has been contributed towards that because they don't condemn such actions. What happened in Kisii at the burial in which MP so and Arati fought is just but a continuation of a pattern that has been happening. We've had the fracas at Kanal, we've had at Githurai, so it's just part of that. But even more worse, we've had politicians insulting the former first lady.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in freedom of speech has limitations.
Sure.
You know, mm-hmm. in certain countries, this person who did that mm-hmm. could have been arrested immediately because
yeah.
she is independent of whether she is the mother of the current president.
Mm-hmm.
On her own right, mm-hmm. she's part of our history.
Yes.
and you may not just wake up and attack her like that. You understand? Because this actually goes then to affect the future generations. If you don't respect the past, you can't respect the current and the future.
Yes.
You know, so that was very, very unfortunate. What happened in Kisii was very unfortunate. I think, and I still insist, the institutions that are mandated to protect our constitutional order and democratic order need to be given more teeth to arrest and to prosecute.
Mm-hmm.
Because the prosecution path of such actions is so cumbersome, so convoluted that they never end in court. So they never end in jail. So they end up repeating the same thing.
And
so
becoming even more famous.
Yes. Actually, do you know the average court case in our country is 5 years? 5 years. It used to be 7 years a while back before, yeah. because you just said 5 years. So by the time you arrest Angeno, for example,
mm-hmm.
when he did that, we arrested him.
Mm-hmm.
When Sudi did that, we arrested him. He was in police cell for like a whole week, of course, and he was really apologetic, said, I'm going to repeat it again. Uh-huh. He said, please, guys, release me.
Mm-hmm.
But here's reality. By the time his case is heard
and
determined,
yeah.
it will be 5 years. So what we are also doing also behind mm-hmm. the scenes is create
yes.
a part of the multi-agency task force is also hook up with the judiciary
yes.
and fast track these cases with a special magistrate whereby because of the stakes are extremely high. We're talking about the security and the future of our country.
Mm-hmm.
This is a national security issue. We say let's allow us to fast track these cases rather than go through the backlog, because it's like a traffic jam. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So if you find here, you have to wait until this one is cleared for you to move.
Yes.
So we are asking for a special lane.
Yeah.
Like, can you give us an express lane rather than go through the regular traffic?
Yes.
Because you're not helping the country either by going through regular traffic.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to happen. Now, in what my friend has said, which is true, institutions, mm-hmm. you know what shocks me, beginning with the parties themselves, the other day you saw a party discipline the members.
Yes.
Okay. Six senators.
Yeah.
Where some of the previous times were MCAs.
Mm-hmm.
For associating or with another political party or doing that. Okay, that's fine. That's within your right.
Yes.
But what actually to me I cannot stand with either political party is when their own members incite
others
mm-hmm. advocate for violence, fund violence. They don't take disciplinary action. You may take action when somebody is with another party,
mm-hmm.
but when actually they break the law mm-hmm. and your own party constitution, because I've read some of the constitution, actually it's forbidden to do that, not just about you associating with another party.
Mm-hmm.
There's certain things you ought to do. There's a code of conduct they have.
Mm-hmm.
So the only way they break their own party code of conduct, they break the law, our penal code, but there is no party whatsoever in this country.
Indeed.
Not even one.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Neither the ORPP, which now we are having a discussion with them, saying, guys, we got to bring these guys in.
Yes.
To say, you know what? You disciplined, you are suspended, or just like these guys were taken out, they're taken out. Because when you incite,
mm-hmm.
when Zamora does what he did,
mm-hmm.
is worse than associating or wearing some cap to a party that you don't agree with.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is people's life. That day in Gidorai, somebody's head was cracked. They had to be taken to Aga Khan. Somebody was died. You understand?
Mm-hmm.
It is people's lives at stake, and then you don't discipline that person, but when that person engages with another party, then there's a party issue. And it's both parties, it's ODM, it's Jubilee, well, like, name them. They all have their responsibility.
And we are seeing the same thing, because with all due respect, Dr. Ari,
yeah.
The NCIC just released a list.
Yeah.
And of course, they were all leaders, unfortunately. Mm. But we haven't seen even some of the parties, these leaders.
Mm-hmm.
They come from a certain party,
yes,
right?
Yes.
By just naming and shaming them, I don't think it was kind of enough.
There's hearsay institutions. We are one of them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. ORPP is there. They are those who deals with political parties
mm-hmm.
and discipline mm-hmm. and all that stuff. So we cannot overstep our mandate
mm-hmm.
to go and deal with party issues, because there's an institution just like us
yeah.
who that is your mandate. And we actually have to talk the behind the scenes deal. With them.
Uh-huh.
And so, you know what, guys, we have to rein in it. So how hopefully they can transfer the same message to the parties and tell them, you know what, if this happens.
Uh-huh.
But let me just say this.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the day, I agree with the institutions that are that. But I think we forget that we as a people,
mm-hmm.
Kenyans, all Kenyans, individually, collectively, have a responsibility. You understand? So we'll do our part. But see, in an ideal situation, we don't need to be there as a commission.
No, absolutely. But you see,
we don't need to be there.
You see, the thing is this. I mean, you have parties suspending, Jubilee's just suspended it, some of its senators.
Yes.
This has no consequence. Because
they're still senators. They are still affiliated.
The process of removing them from being senators is more convoluted, more complex. And even your organization naming and shaming, these people don't get ashamed, even if you name them. So this, again, also has no consequence. I think, like I said before, these institutions need to be given teeth.
Mm-hmm.
Teeth to arrest, prosecute, and jail if found guilty. You know. That's all what needs to be done.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, just by naming a list of people.
Mm-hmm. And of course, in Muranga, yeah. Keno, we also had some skirmishes a while
ago. People's life.
And of course, yes.
Young people's lives, yes.
Yes, but of course, we never saw any names appear in your
actually,
list.
Muranga, let me say something about Muranga. Because of what happened in Muranga and Gidorai, there's a special investigation going on.
Mm-hmm.
That was in the power of the DCI, because of criminal activity that happened.
Mm-hmm.
So they're investigating. We're aiding in the investigation.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it will take a while. Because what also we see, and you know very well, there's a threshold to evidence that comes to court. Sometimes you arrest somebody, and there's a pressure to arrest because they just did something wrong,
mm-hmm.
apparently it seems.
Mm-hmm.
And then they see the judge and the court doesn't work the way we do, the public
yes.
court of opinion.
Mm-hmm.
So, and also you see some of these guys getting acquitted very easily.
Mm-hmm.
So, rather than give them that quick avenue to be acquitted, So we said, you know what, it has to be a robust investigation, mm-hmm. a concrete evidence.
Yes.
It's ironclad. Mm-hmm. So when these guys go to court, mm-hmm. okay, we know for sure they will get convicted. Mm-hmm. Because when you also work with the DPP, they tell you, okay, it's one thing for you to say, it looks like they say it, but you know what, they has to, you go to court, there has to be clear evidence. Mm-hmm. So for Githurai, everyone I can tell you there is actually still ongoing investigation. I can't comment much about it. Mm-hmm. But what I can say is this, mm-hmm. for sure, those who were behind it, and it's really on both sides. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, as much as you say, I agree with you, they should be prosecuted. The moment you arrest somebody, you're always accused of, you're taking sides. You're targeting a certain clique of people. Mm-hmm. Yesterday, you saw two leaders getting arrested, Deputy Governor of Kisii, Nyang'i, and Osoro himself. Mm-hmm. And you saw what the criticism was. Now, I don't know, personally, I don't know why they were arrested. So I really can't comment on that. But you see, personally, I can comment on that. But you see, and the comment, even before people knew where the arrest was, like, where they're being targeted because.
Yes.
Now, if I myself, in my position, I didn't know why these people didn't know why they were arrested. Mm-hmm. You understand? Maybe there's clear evidence of them as they being accused. Mm-hmm. I haven't seen it. I will have probably access later to see the information mm-hmm. and why they were arrested, but I haven't. So neither can you can say, well, arrested because of this. Neither can you say, I arrested because of this, because for us, mm-hmm. the police haven't really given us clear directive as to why they were arrested. Mm-hmm.
There are some cases where the evidence is so clear. For example, the fight between Simbarati and Osoro. I mean, this was captured on TV live.
Yes.
So you cannot say there is no evidence. Mm-hmm. You understand? And none of them has been arrested for assault.
So far,
you see that?
We just
see
their names.
Not, the whole nation watched.
Of course.
Mm-hmm. The whole nation watched it happen. Mm-hmm. But the institutions that are supposed to act did nothing.
Don't.
So that is encouraging such acts to continue happening mm-hmm. because they need to act immediately so that the whole country knows the next person that may be predisposed to do certain things like that knows that if I do it, I end up in jail. Mm-hmm. If two people fought on the streets of Nairobi today, the police will arrest them. They will be taken to court and taken to jail. But now, two politicians fighting in front of the deputy president, mm-hmm. fighting in front of the former prime minister, mm-hmm. with all the dignitaries present, on live TV.
In a burial ceremony.
In a burial ceremony.
It's not even a political
ceremony. In a burial ceremony. And then they let go.
And Ojanga, you are a political strategist. Looking at all the names, perhaps, that NCIC shamed, there's a common denominator. These are very young politicians. What is happening to the clique of young politicians that we have?
A culture is developing in this country in which, number one, you have to indulge in corruption, mm-hmm. you know, to show off. Number two, you need to hire goons to show your strength. Mm-hmm. Number three, you have to make a lot of noise, which are meaningless to be considered a leader. So if we are not careful as a country, our definition of leadership will tend to go more towards crooks. Mm-hmm. So to be a leader in Kenya means you must be crooked
ready
enough. Even kill, do bad things. Mm-hmm. You know, that gives you visibility, because that's what the society is now beginning to enjoy. And that's why I said the media must also play its role by either condemning and giving these people some sort of blackout.
Actually, still on the media. Yeah. Perhaps, okay, you can respond to that first.
I think it was 3 years ago, Nation newspaper did an article. Mm-hmm. If I remember, it's called The Rise of Bad Boy Politics. Mm-hmm. The time Michael's getting elected, mm-hmm. we saw Babu getting elected. Mm-hmm. A while back, there used to be this hope that, you know, the young leaders will do better than the previous ones, especially the Moi era leaders. And to me, the biggest disappointment. And I'm part of this young leadership, and so it's a collective responsibility of my generation. I think it's embarrassing. Mm-hmm. Let me just to say that that's the truth. But let me give you context, okay, to this, so people can understand societal framework that we live in. Mm-hmm. I think it was 4 years ago, I think the Aga Khan University did a survey, mm-hmm. and it was published widely, that 64%, I think it was 64%, if you remember the number correctly, of young people, they did a survey that they says they didn't care or didn't mind how they got rich, even if it's stealing, mm-hmm. doesn't really matter. You know, it is okay.
Don't get
64% agree that the end is just about the means. So yeah. The means is just about the end. So it doesn't really matter. Now you see this 64% of people, that was like almost 4 or 5 years ago, mm-hmm. the ones who are voting now, mm-hmm. and what do you expect? Mm-hmm. Of course, our moral compass is broken, okay? Our value systems, mm-hmm. to which we espouse in our constitution, mm-hmm. is non-existent, okay? Therefore, let's not forget, bad people, I always say this, cannot elect good leaders. Neither can good people elect bad leaders. What you see of these young leaders mm-hmm. is a reflection of us. As they were elected. These MPs were elected by people like us, like you and me. Okay? So they're a reflection of who we are. So as much as we can point a finger, we start with us. Then, like you said, the media sort of plays a big part in this.
Yes.
Because, like in this group, the editors are complaining they don't have a headline tomorrow. So we always want to sensationalize. Mm-hmm. On the list of shame and we give, it is always the focus, not the list of fame, the people who've done good, it is the criminals, the thugs, the people who are, and that's we sensationalize. So it's society, the culture that produces and elects these leaders, mm-hmm. and then because, of course, you're in a business, also you have to be in business, mm-hmm. ratings have to be considered, mm-hmm. you have to sell newspapers, mm-hmm. we have, people have to watch your news, mm-hmm. if it's boring, then no one's going to watch you.
But not as a cost.
Perhaps, Ojanga, you can respond to that. Yeah. I remember in 2007, 2008, during the post-election violence, the media actually played a key role in fanning the violence, and we also even had some, Joshua Sang was even arrested and taken to The Hague for the same. But as you look at the media now, do you believe that we are doing far much better than we have been doing? Or as Daktari rightly put it, our editors are looking for that juicy story?
I don't think so. In East Africa, we have real examples what the media can do to a society in terms of ability to destroy society. Mm-hmm. In the genocide of Rwanda, mm-hmm. the Interahamwe relied very much on Radio Milcolin, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Without Radio Milcolin, there would not have been genocide in Rwanda. So the only difference is that what we experience here is slightly milder. We have situations where the former governor of Nairobi, Kestrel Stage, right? Mm-hmm. insults the president and his family, mm-hmm. and become part of news.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this should be given total blackout.
Yeah.
You know, but you know, oh, the former governor has taken on the president, mm-hmm. and we derive joy from that. Like I said, the institutions we have, the institutions that actually respond for our culture, mm-hmm. what we may or may not do. These people are government payroll and also live from our tax money. They must do their job. They must be able to enforce what is valid here, what should be valid within the cultural context of the Republic of Kenya, not. Mm-hmm. You know, that way we can shape a society. There are a lot of things in many countries. I went to school in Germany and lived partially also in Switzerland. Mm-hmm. There are certain things that even the normal common man mm-hmm. cannot even afford to say in front of two people. But in Kenya, the most prominent people use the most vulgar language mm-hmm. that is then broadcasted on TV when kids are seen.
Mm-hmm.
So that helps to perpetuate the culture of irresponsibility, recklessness, and all sorts of things, you know? You know, denies our kids to develop as kids with dignity and responsibility and all that, you know, and also denies the future generation from respecting the basic laws of our constitution, because if our elders, the people we elect, our leaders don't respect, why should we? You know, so this conversation, I suppose, Dr. Macquarie, this needs to be taken a lot more further, because this is even more worse than corruption. If you corrupt the the morals of a society, then you open the Pandora's box for the occurrence of many, many more other things.
And perhaps to add on that, mm-hmm. During the 2007-2008, we didn't have as many radio stations as we have. We didn't have a robust social media platform like the one we have right now. So in case we play the card that we played in 2007, the consequences could be dire. So what as a commission are you doing to actually tame those media houses or media platforms that are offering an opportunity for leaders to perpetuate hate? I remember Interior Cabinet Secretary talking about, Dr. Matiang'i, talking about he's not happy with some of the radio stations in the north,
yes.
Especially looking at the skirmishes that we had in Marsabit.
Yes.
We also have some issues in Mandera. We also have some issues there.
Okay. Thanks, actually, because I was going to comment on that.
Yes.
So to that end,
yes.
The first week of March, we're meeting with all editors in this country, Editors Guild. Through the Editors Guild and the Media Council of Kenya and the CAK. So we've called in all these bodies together. But mostly our target is the editors because they are the ones who determine what goes on air, what's printed. Like you said, you go to a rally, there's 2 hours of people talking, but you look for the most controversial.
Exactly.
You know, okay. Exactly. That is what, because I've been to these rallies, because we monitor them, mm-hmm. We're there on the ground, and it's sometimes 3-4 hours, people talk, but you pick the most incendiary one to broadcast. So
the most unpleasant thing that happened in the rally.
And now we have social media.
Yeah. So what we are doing, and I'll go to social media, let's begin with traditional media. We're meeting all the editors to their guild and the Media Council of Kenya. We don't want to talk to the owners per se because the editors are to determine content that goes on the air. And just to remind them, have a discourse that they have a responsibility towards a peaceful and cohesive country. Then they ought to work to say what we call responsible journalism. How is that? We saw towards the end of the election cycle in the US, mm-hmm. whereby the what we call the broadcast channels in the US, CBS, ABC, NBC, and CNN will give. On the press conference with Trump in the White House, they'll give a blackout, especially when he goes to demagoguery and ranting about crazy things. Mm-hmm. They actually black him out. So the only people who, you know, aired that was Fox News. Mm-hmm. And that actually did help. And we saw how it helped him so by these people. That, you know, there are things you cannot say. If you want air, speak soberly. So that's the reason we're doing. Secondly, we signed an MOU with CAK, the Commission Authority of Kenya. What we want to understand mm-hmm. is 90% of incitement happens online. Mm-hmm. Yes. Forget about KC, what politicians say, one or two words.
Yes.
90%.
The Facebook.
Yes.
Yes.
Is online. If I was to give you the report that we get most of the time early in the morning, mm-hmm. in hotspots areas like Marsabit, Isiolo, and you see what happens in these WhatsApp groups, Facebooks, mm-hmm. it is dangerous. What are we doing? One of the things that we're doing with the CAK is be able to communicate now officially to Facebook and Twitter to ban these groups. Because they're literally endangering national security. And the content is there, it's very clear. It is, I mean, and the propaganda is there, it's dangerous. And what we see, what happened in the US, is this echo chamber now they exist in, like QAnon, whereby it's conspiracy. We say what we want to hear mm-hmm. and incite one another, against, especially in northern Kenya, against another group, ethnic group, they say these guys, something small happens. And believing by the time you know what the truth is, it has been distorted. And as we speak, you know the danger is, people understand the danger is, that's why we have to shut them down. Mm-hmm. It's not to inhibit free speech. I am the biggest proponent of free speech. I am. But our constitution is very clear, chapter 4. It says, only to an extent where what you say does not
infringe
yes. Propaganda to war and incitement. Yes. You understand? Yes. And people, yesterday, people died in Marsabit. 3 days people to that died. Every day, people, and it doesn't get to news. Mm-hmm. Sometimes which I guess it's a good thing. Mm-hmm. But there are people on the ground, they know it must have been, they know when people are dying, and it's pushed in these media groups.
Yeah.
So we'll shut them down. Mm-hmm. Those ones have to be shut down.
You're saying yes. that moving forward, we see yes. the situation that we saw in America, the
yes.
Facebook, Twitter, they all
they're basically bound to Trump. Yes.
Because
he was a danger of national security.
Yes.
So there are certain groups that we are banning in this country, not because we don't want free speech, it's yes. because they are a threat to national security. And then we'll be back.
We are waiting.
No, no.
Yeah,
but this
I mean, it's one thing for Facebook or Twitter to ban them, but also we also have capability locally to track these people. You understand? I mean, I think the institution of the NSIS has the capability to track these people and bring them to book. In what happened for Twitter, in the case of Twitter and Facebook with Trump, they blocked him because he's got following which goes worldwide. It's usually very difficult for business enterprise like Facebook to focus on a group in Omaha Bay, for example. But it's in the jurisdiction of the institutions that have been mandated to have to enforce certain behavior within a country to do so. So I think we need to develop mechanisms that would hinder such occurrences. And that capability and ability to do so does really exist.
No, it does. Yeah. And sometimes people don't, you know, we always said we're not doing much, we always accused of being a toothless, which is, and let me tell you to that. Let me tell you, you know what we're doing? There's 450 cases right now we're pursuing.
Really?
Out of that 200 already in court. Uh-huh. This is quite low-level people who are inciting on social media. Mm-hmm. You understand? Like you said, we have capability to track. You know, these guys think they can hide under anonymity.
Yes.
You know, so it's true, and we're doing it. And I can tell you, we've expended resources across the country, and sometimes the guys go in hiding, and we've been tracking them. They've arrested them. Of course, we don't announce every time we arrest them, like we arrested some, you know, little folk out there in Isiolo, because it's a nobody. Mm-hmm. But you see, that nobody is really causing serious damage to the community or the community.
It's only nobody in the context that is not been given visibility through the media, but the impact of his actions are more grave.
Very true. than even some politicians. Yeah. That's why we have, right now, as we speak, we have 200 active cases in court. 200. A majority of them, it is these guys who people don't know, but they're really pushing hate and rhetoric, and some of them.
We will have a problem if we take 5 years to prosecute them, and we still have other pending, and we don't know if some other politicians might decide today I can speak the way I want. Because looking at what happened, and especially in Kisii, that was really bad, and we saw it, everybody saw it, but we never even saw these people being arrested. That's really dents a lot when you say that we are going to act, and you can see
they were making press statements immediately after the fight.
Yes, they were making press, and they even become even more. You're looking at the internet, you see that their names have been Googled even more after that.
They're trending.
Yes, they're trending.
I agree. You know, this has to be a multi-agency task force, and Kenya doesn't understand that in the law. What they did they should be charged under public breaking the public order act.
Yes.
Okay. Both of them to an extent. Mm-hmm. Well, one more largely. Mm-hmm. And if the ideal way mm-hmm. is for Arati to charge to press charges of assault against Osoro because he was attacked. He was literally on the stage talking to these guys. So that is, see, until he pressed the charges,
yes,
it really had these guys, I will hide, there's nothing you can do, but there's nothing you can do because two things happened. Mm-hmm. First of all, there was a serious breach of security, mm-hmm. If you really understand our security operations, especially where VIPs are involved, mm-hmm. there's a very serious breach of security where the deputy president was and the former prime minister was, okay? And they had to bring, if you saw those clips, they had to bring a special contingent of security, which is always behind the scenes. These guys are never visible for a very good reason. Mm-hmm. You only see these guys with suits and earpieces like yours. Mm-hmm. But for those guys to come in, I don't want to say much, but something was very, very, very wrong. That's the last resort when it comes to security for VIPs, especially the head of state, the deputy of state. Mm-hmm. But also they broke the public order, mm-hmm. okay? So they should have been charged that. And the only person who can do that is the police. The only person who should arrest those guys are the police DCI. So why they don't, mm-hmm. that is up to them. But as far as the act itself, the physical act is itself concerned, the only people who should have acted, and they can still act if pushed, would be our police.
There's a country in this country which every major politician has got a group of attack dogs, political attack dogs. And as you said before, political parties should be able to actually punish
their own members when they do wrong.
Discipline them.
But now, these people have got special positions within these political parties because they protect the political leader. They're the ones that do certain things that the political leader may not do publicly. True. So basically, they're saying that like attack dogs, like German Shepherd dogs, they go to bite the opponents. These are the things that institutions like yours should be able to address. I mean, talk to the political leadership and say you cannot have a group of youth wings, violent youth that cause mayhem, that fight. The other time when Honorable Senator Gideon was going to be sworn in as a lead,
elder.
He woke up and fought hundreds of them on the streets. Who paid for that? Mm-hmm. Nobody's ever asked. Who paid these youths? You know, somebody somewhere didn't want that to happen. So unemployed youth are brought together, paid, to do certain things. It was very fortunate that he didn't act. Otherwise, there would have been blood. Maybe there would have been actually assault on the Honorable Senator himself.
Yeah.
Because at some point, one of them actually climbed us on the vehicle with a rumbu.
Yeah.
You know, it was very scary.
Mm-hmm.
So these are things that we must condemn as a society and punish.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and when we do that, it won't happen again. Because our children will grow knowing very well this is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. And perhaps before we go for a break, I remember we mentioned names like Fafi MP, Abdi Karim Osman, Mohammed,
yes,
Ojora MP, Charity Kadambi, as the two leaders who have really shown that they really want to boost Chapter 6 of integrity and accountability. What more can be done to encourage?
We need
the leaders to be on this list.
What we're doing next month, because it's going to be a monthly list, we're publishing the more comprehensive list.
Uh-huh. That was,
yeah, so the new
this
list
month.
Is coming.
Uh-huh.
Should be next month.
Okay.
Because we just published one the other.
Mm-hmm.
This was there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what can be done? Just before actually what can be done, let me just briefly, if you allow me, just very briefly,
mm-hmm.
talk about Abdi Karim.
Yeah.
Abdi Karim was in a rally in Garissa. There's serious conflict between Garissa and Isiolo.
Mm-hmm.
And he's from Garissa, Garissa MP, Fafi. And he was being goaded by the crowd
mm-hmm.
to incite them concerning the issue of Isiolo.
Mm-hmm.
Because the TSCS has just removed chiefs from Isiolo and took it back to Garissa. They have come from Garissa. For years, they say, you know, guys, go back. We have to have Florida. So Garissa people are in theory, the leaders are in theory, everybody's upset. So everybody, every leader who came there was breathing hell in theory, saying how they'll do this and this. So his turn comes, and they're goading him. And he said, no.
I'm not going to do that.
Not only am I going to do that, he didn't call them out. He said, listen, if it's going to take for me to incite people, for me to be elected, I'd rather not be elected. There is almost no leader in this country who can say that publicly to a crowd that is hundreds of thousands that is goading you
supporters.
To tell them what you want them to hear.
Yeah.
It takes tremendous courage to some people say, I'm not going to incite you. Mm-hmm. And first of all, what you're saying is wrong. Not only that, he said, listen, I in my country promote diversity and inclusion and cohesion. As a matter of fact, he says, I have chiefs from this community, because there they have clan issues.
Mm-hmm.
He says, I have chiefs from the Gare, from the Godias.
Mm-hmm.
And I will not allow you guys to tell me to jump into this bandwagon of hating. Yes, the Boranas. You understand?
But most of the times,
unfortunately, we're going to revisit that on how we can encourage more leaders, of course, to be on the list of fame, not a list of shame. But we'll be right back in case you just joined us. This is NewsCheck, and we are looking at the political divide, of course, fostering a national cohesion, unity, and of course, maintaining law and order in all factions, including media, politicians, and just Kenyans. We just need to be one. I'm joined by Dr. Danvas Makori, who is an NCIC commissioner, and Tom Ojanga, who is a political strategist. And of course, we will be getting back to this deeper conversation. And of course, we will be looking at what has been happening in politics. We saw the change of Senate leadership, and of course, some parties also disciplining their members. We'll be right back.
mwaka mpya vitu mpya kwenye quickbit.co.ke. Siku ya leo ni Samsung A51.
Oh yes, na ni rahisi sana. Unaenda kwenye Lipa na Mpesa. Paybill number ni 403-2353. 403-2353. Account ni SM. Iyo ndiyo kodi ambayo ya